All right, we're live.
Did she? Did you get? Have you ever given her like one of those?
Stop.
We're not lecturing.
We're,
if I ever meet her, I'm just gonna take her glass of water and slowly move it away. Away.
You can't get this up.
She's top heavy.
Oh god.
Oh. You guys are Greg, you're terrible.
I won't throw her.
I've seen the memes.
Why
should I? Shit.
Yeah, you're
supposed
to. I know
all your jerks. Wasn't that one funny when Kat was about to offer on Sims?
No, Sims isn't this, trying to be great.
Yeah, I thought you weren't going to show those.
Change of heart. Yeah, gotta get ready because you're coming
around. Well, welcome to the Circle of Trust. Wait till you see the ones of Kat.
I feel like I showed them.
I've seen them.
Blackface?
Yeah, I've seen the one on the first day of school.
Not that far off.
Good.
Nope. Alright, ready?
Yeah.
Here we go. Welcome to We Are Libertarians. I am your host, Chris Spangle. We are doing a special live and on-the-road edition of We Are Libertarians in lovely, lovely Muncie, Indiana at the house of Kat Anagnos and her sorority sisters. With me is Greg Lenz.
Chris, how are you, buddy? This is exciting.
I'm very, very excited, and I hope anybody can hear you. So
that's
let me
preferable, probably. Yeah.
Keep talking.
Hello, hello, hello. Hello, hello.
Oh,
hello, hello.
Shit.
Is this good?
Yeah, you're very, very loud.
Mm-hmm. We kind of already knew that.
Oh. Mm. Hilarious. Why don't you self abort?
I've tried so many times. No one will let me kill myself.
It was late stage, 135th trimester.
Katie's losing it.
I knew that.
What? You started it. I didn't say a word.
I didn't say a single
You
word.
Said, imagine that. Wow.
Test, 1, 2, 3. Come back. This is your scat cat. A peep it up. Put up it up a doop.
Okay, that's you.
Where you start?
Greg, me.
Hello, hello.
And then Katie, you're on this one.
Hello.
Keep talking.
Hello, Chris. How are you?
I'm doing well.
Chris.
And Gina, you're on this one. Okay, perfect.
Okay,
got it.
Where you start?
All right, here we go. Welcome to We Are Libertarians. I'm your host, Chris Spangle. We are the podcast that brings you all of the irreverence modern politics deserves, and we are live on location. I forgot my script, so we don't have the normal script, but you know the deal. Like us on Facebook, find us on iTunes, rate and review us, donate on Patreon, and blah, 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 blah. The last episode was a little more news. This episode, again, we're going to talk some politics, but we are live and on location with Kat Anagnos and her sorority sisters up here in lovely Muncie, Indiana. And with me, as always, is Greg Lenz. Greg, glad you made the trip up.
Man, I am so excited to be here. I could not be more ready to just have a group shaming of Kat Anagnos.
Oh.
Kat looks like nobody introduced me yet.
Kat is here. Kat, how are you?
Hello, everyone. It's so good to be back.
Yes, it's, I don't know why you thought this was a good idea.
Well, here's the thing. I'm used to being publicly shamed every time I'm on your podcast.
Right.
We Are Libertarians.
Right.
So I thought this time, you know, it's in the rules, you know, rules are in my rules, my house, my rules, that it'd be fun. And I've been telling so many stories of the roommates, I thought it would be fun. You guys got to meet them.
I've heard so much about you guys.
I'm hoping that's a good thing.
She read your diary and told me everything, Katie.
I'm not surprised.
This is Katie. We're not going to say last names because we want them to have careers. And associating with us is just too much in the first place.
Boring people hate us.
Well, here's the problem. Kat, like, to make herself look more famous, Greg, has not only told them,
famous.
Not only told them how big this podcast is,
huge,
and but also like how offensive it is, and so like two of the roommates won't even come on because they're too scared. Because and like
they'll come on. We'll
what's been your perception of the podcast, Katie?
Well, Kat has made it seem that like the minute you guys were coming into our house, it was gonna be like a roast session of all of us.
And I left the Confederate flag in the truck.
Yeah. So we were all a little scared to meet you. I thought it was just gonna be like immediate like.
And have we
getting at me.
Have we fulfilled that?
Slightly, but not as much as Kat said. So.
Yes, and then also with
that's because she lies.
How often does Kat lie?
She's CNN.
Basically. Also with us is Gina. Let's introduce Gina. How are you doing?
I'm good.
She is very quiet, very nervous. Gina, now you are not. You don't live in the house, right?
No.
You're just a friend.
No,
she
lives.
She lives.
Well, you do.
She tried to burn it.
Just because she got kicked out of the sorority.
Yeah. I'm actually not a sister.
Oh.
I was.
She's a brother.
She
Can I say, would blackballed be the right term?
Oh. God. I told you to be nice, Greg.
No, I think she's the best. I don't know why Jackie kicked her out.
In the wings, who will eventually come on? We know it. Jackie and Jordan, they're here as well. They're the two people who have to put up with Kat. I mean, Jordan, in the bonus segment, at least for we have a Patreon, and the people that donate, they subscribe, they get a special bonus segment of the show. And I want you to come on in that segment and tell the story you told us before.
Oh my God.
And also about the chair I'm sitting in,
okay.
And tell the embarrassing stories about Kat. Will you please do that for us?
Okay.
I'm very excited. So Gina lives here. Gina, are you the one that almost burnt the place down the other day?
Yes.
What were you cooking?
Turkey burger. Yeah.
How original, another vegan.
It's not even real meat. It's not.
It's turkey.
If you're going to burn a house down, do it over pizza or steak or something.
It was a stovetop. Stovetop fire, you know.
Oh, okay. You were frying the burger.
Mm-hmm.
Listen, Gina watched Breaking Bad. She got inspired. You know.
Well, it is Muncie. Meth is, you know, it's profitable here.
Right. Exactly.
Yes.
Pay my tuition. Yeah.
Now, Katie, you, this is your second year living with Kat, isn't it?
It is. I lived with Kat in the dorms last year.
I need you to confirm or deny something.
I will. Probably.
Not only does Kat pee in cups at
yes.
night.
Yes. Every word Kat has said on the podcast about her peeing in any form of container is absolutely true.
Gina, you were very quick to say yes.
Mm-hmm.
Have you been peed on?
Not by Kat, but she's into some really weird stuff. You know what I mean?
Gina, are you single? Just made.
You know Donald Trump.
Kat just spewed juice everywhere.
My apple juice, no.
I told you to go before the show.
Hey, sorry.
Now, so you've been peed on by lovers.
No.
Oh, okay. Now, raise of hands. This is a moment of honesty. We're going to have a lot of truth in this podcast.
I'm also really nervous.
Raise your... Yeah, why did you think this was a good
idea? I don't know. I just thought it'd be nice bringing my worlds together.
Yeah. Who thinks that that is the most disgusting thing they've ever heard?
What?
One?
What, getting peed on by...
No, peeing in a cup every night.
And then letting it distill for several days.
Yes.
Alright, so Jordan and Jackie are raising their hand. Gina,
maybe not that I've ever heard, but it was disgusting.
Katie's on the fence.
Yeah.
It's weird, they all seem very accepting of it.
No, because yeah. I got really used to it.
This is actually a urine intervention. You didn't know that. We came here to send you away from
it. Now, for those of you who want to see Kat's pee sink, I will put it on the Instagram. We got a photo before the podcast.
I'm thumbs upping in front of the...
In the pee sink. So go check out our Instagram if you want to see it. So, Kat, you've been back at school. We talked a lot about on the last podcast you coming back to school.
Yeah.
I had the time of my life hanging out with you, like, 80 hours a week.
Spangle and I are holding hands and touching each other's forearms.
Gently.
Gently.
Do it again!
This is how blind people shake hands. Yeah.
Literally. No, like Ray Charles, he used to, when he would shake a woman's hand, feel her wrist to see if she was heavy. So, here, Katie, shake my hand. Let me
okay,
see.
Hold on.
All right.
Oh, God.
All right, here.
Freshman 15 is still
yeah.
still on to me.
Aww.
Now,
just fat shamed
a girl who's barely 100 pounds.
Literally, based on what she told me, her level of friendship and commitment to Kat and Agnos, and I want to bring
honestly,
it up. Stunning.
Stunning. Absolutely stunning.
You don't
I'm
find
shocked.
That kind of friendship ever.
Explain that. What do you mean?
I'm not going to talk about it because it's disgusting.
Well,
but
me and Kat, like, obviously lived in, like, a dorm last year. It was probably, like...
Heavy doors.
Yeah. Like, it was
right.
probably, like, 6 inches wide. It was so tiny.
Right.
And for some reason, it always just got really, really, really dirty. And then there was, like, the pee cups on top of that. And I just kind of, like, got accustomed to living with it. That it just kind of became my norm.
She's the pee-pupper.
You're the one that dumps it out?
No, that's Jordan.
Jordan.
She did it one time.
She did one time.
Katie just rearranges it into a pyramid.
I was just
Katie's playing Flippy Cup with it.
Who wants to play beer pong? We should run.
No, but the level, like, here's the thing. I only have loyal friends.
Right.
Hence why I'm a part of We Are Libertarians.
Right.
And my friends here are extremely loyal, especially because they put up with me being in cups.
Apparently they put up a lot, because we've learned a lot in this evening. Like,
I don't have a problem with the peeing in the cup. I have a problem with you letting it, like, ferment.
That was right. Only a few times, and I was busy, you know, school.
I was busy.
No, English? It would, like, English, yeah, because it would sit there for a few days, and then it, like, started to get a little cloudy.
So
that's when I was, like, that's when I would start, like...
Well, Katie, that was the marijuana.
Yeah. Excuse me.
Dun, dun, dun.
Oh, Gina, what is the best part of living with Kat and Agnos?
Notice the
long
pause.
Yes. Not sure.
All these choices.
Oh, I don't know. That's, can I have a second?
You need to phone a friend?
Let's go back to Katie.
Yeah,
Katie.
I can answer.
Hi,
yeah,
guys. Where are the fucking cue cards I gave you?
I'll name a few things. It's like a nightly ritual in this house. Kat and Jordan have their, like, daily, like, argument, and they just start, like, beating the shit out of each other.
Is that true?
What? Absolutely.
So,
like, I got choked out the other night.
Literally, they...
Are you serious?
I mean, but enough about
you've been so subdued all night.
It usually happens at, like, 10.
You gotta come talk on the mic.
Yeah, come on, Jordan.
Come sit next to Gina. Come on.
She's too shy.
Yeah,
there
chair
we
mine.
Go. The third roommate.
Let's be
Jordan
clear, this isn't the first couch you've sat on. Good job.
Now, Jordan, do you guys actually, like, have hardcore fights?
I mean, yeah, sometimes. Like, the other day, I literally choked Kat out.
And I slapped her in the face.
Yeah.
Is this, like, foreplay, or? Sorry, asking for a friend.
This fight led into Kat sneaking in Jordan's window. This was all in the same night.
You set that up as totally different.
Okay, but crawling in my window was still really creepy.
It's crime.
Which we will explain in the bonus segment if you want to hear the whole thing. But, like, so the best part of having her live here is that she gets in fights.
Yeah, I think it's funny because I'm never, like, involved in the fight. I'm always just, like, bystander.
Here's,
like,
the
letting
thing.
It happen.
What will
I just
now?
Like, I like wrestling. Yeah, Kat does.
Wrestling
with
or
women.
Wrestling?
Both.
With women, right.
Yeah, with women. Look, just because I like having sex with women doesn't mean that I'm a lesbian.
Katie, how many girls has Kat kissed?
I don't know.
Is it in the dozens?
Zero.
Honestly, it's kind of prohibitive when you have urine cups sitting around your bed.
No, the thing is, like, whenever, like, we all go out and we're all, like, having a good time, I'm always like, guys, can we kiss? And then
right.
Kat is like, no, Katie. And I'm just, like, trying to hang.
Right. So
I'm just trying to be friends.
You're friends.
What's both noses?
It's
not weird.
Let's Eskimo. Greg and I have never Eskimo kissed.
No.
That's a lie. I saw you two rub noses together.
No, you did not.
Oh, never mind. That was my other podcast.
No,
yeah,
so because
anyone else would allow you on.
Like, I feel bad for Kat because the lesbian thing isn't true, and she's
not even remotely
lesbian.
No.
Like,
well, just Taylor Swift.
Right. Really, and we gotta talk about that, yeah.
Yeah.
But I think it's just because, like, why does she go on dates?
Yes.
Ooh, really? Like this
yeah,
year?
Actually,
when's the
I
last...
like to keep my personal life and my podcast life separate. So
why did you?
Yeah. When
why did you raw dog so many randoms and think it wouldn't come up?
When was the last date that she went on?
It's been a while.
Yesterday.
Have you...
at this church.
Stop looking at her. Look at me. How many?
Don't look me in the eyes, Katie.
Does she go on a lot of dates?
She hasn't gone on a date yet this year that I know of, but you definitely like met that one boy.
Ooh. All right. So there's been a boy,
Jordan.
Okay. Here's the thing with Kat and boys.
Oh God, stop.
You
better be really careful.
I know we're gonna be fine. It's fine, Kat.
She's
talking about this today, and Kat and I decided that she used to really be into like the preppy kind of guys,
uh-huh.
And now she's moving into like the dirty. Kind of guys.
Oh, I don't like this at all.
It's a crime. It's a problem.
And she also gets asked on a lot of dates and then just cuts off all communication with the guy she's talking to.
I have a problem.
Yeah, you really don't like intimacy.
No.
Yeah.
I have to be the one to initiate.
Right.
Predator.
Alright, so we've established that Kat will date a boy, but she has to like you. So all you creepers that are sliding in her DMs, which is a lot, right?
There's a fair few. I enjoy the attention.
Yes.
Now and then. I enjoy a good bomb threat.
Now, what was the thing that happened that I was just going to bring up that we were going to talk about?
Church date. Very short.
All right. For the record, I would like to say something
before
Greg.
The mobility challenge, young
man. No. I would like to say something before Greg and Spangle get in. A nice boy who is part of our friends,
mm-hmm.
he
That's very
tried
loose
to sell me weed.
Did not.
He did.
So he's from this town where I go to school, and he, like, I told him I would go get lunch with him or hang out with him, and I haven't because I've been busy, and he was selling, like, fruit on the side of the road,
mm-hmm.
and so I.
Oh, wow.
The other day, so we just
how are the blueberries?
Well, and we just went, and I got a picture with him, and said hello, and now I'm here. But of course, you two, along with Chewy Jer.
Oh, whoa, hey, I mean
echoes.
Oh,
sorry, the boss hog of liberty.
There you go.
Just make things up about it. What? I'm not allowed to call him that. That's his name in the group chat.
Because that belongs in group chat.
We're only anti-Semitic in private.
Jesus.
You guys need to tell me this kind of thing.
Not everybody wrote a song about Hitler in 7th grade and
then
sang it.
8th grade, and I got an A on that project.
And then you dated the guy that made nerve gas.
Now you see why I have problems with men. That's the root of it all.
How much are you, on a level of 1 to 10, Kat, how much are you hating this right now?
Like, probably like a... Because here's the thing.
Okay.
My school reputation and my summer / podcast professional reputation
uh-huh.
are very different, right? Greg is air quoting. You know, the summer and on the podcast and whatnot, the day job, I was a bit of a legend. You
mm-hmm.
know, everybody thought I was cool and
mm-hmm.
funny and talented. And then I get back to school and, like I said last week or 2 weeks ago, everybody treats me like dirt.
Right.
And so,
it's
because you
fight them and break into their rooms on a daily basis.
That was one time. But anyway, so, you know, I've been talking up how popular I am and how cool I am.
Which you are. You are popular and you are cool.
Yes.
I think you are.
Well, thank you.
Jordan?
Not so much.
No, what is... All right.
If she broke into your bedroom window, would you
Greg,
feel...
Greg, I've done it to you before and you've never said anything.
Honestly, I don't want to make this awkward, but I'd be into it, Greg.
There we go.
Is this like roleplay or what?
Now, Jordan, we need to play Dr. Phil.
Oh, God.
Yes.
This is not about to be the next wall party.
No, not Jordan. What?
Apparently
what,
had more legs than we thought.
What? Yeah, apparently. There's an afterlife. Romance was...
I've never dated an Uber customer. How's it going?
Now, Jordan, what is your beef with Kat? Why are you fighting with her?
We don't have any beef. We just, like...
It's like a stress reliever.
Yeah, that's exactly it.
Yeah.
That is the perfect way to put it.
You know that she's going to forgive you if you're crazy and vice versa.
Exactly.
Oh, yeah. That's why I went to our window to try and, like, get her move.
Okay. Passionate people.
Yeah. I mean, yeah.
Yeah.
We hold hands. We're holding hands right now.
Now, Jordan, what is your major?
Elementary education.
All right. You're going to be a teacher.
Yes, I am.
Have you student taught yet?
Not yet.
How many children do you plan on yelling at?
It's usually on average 27 to 30, so... In between
there. You're getting a lot of practice right now.
About
25.
No, they treat me like I'm a child.
Well,
you have a timeout chair.
Yeah.
We're gonna talk about that later. Let's save it for the bonus hour. We're trying to sell subscriptions here, people. If you want to hear the bonus content, you gotta be a premium member here. Now, Gina, what is your favorite thing about living with Kat? Have you figured
and then
out?
Your major after?
I think my favorite thing would be how she flings eggshells everywhere when she peels her hard-boiled eggs.
She throws everything.
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 I'm upset.
But she also, I have two things. Second thing, she gives very nice head massages.
Oh, yeah.
I found that out yesterday. That was very irritating.
I know, she was my intern.
There was no heavy-headed.
There was, we never had.
She rubs your skull?
She did.
She
no,
gave me
with mint lotion.
They all
and
complain of headaches.
Yeah.
James Deese, let's take a question. We have a secret group that we live stream to.
Not James Deese.
And so you can ask questions of us while we're live streaming. Now, ladies, need you to raise your hand when I in the affirmative if this is you. James wants to know, question for the panel, which of you are not on birth control asking for myself?
Oh. I mean, I'll be
No, it's a joke.
You know?
I mean, I didn't say yes
That's
or
risky.
No. I didn't say yes or no.
Anyways,
it's
time to keep
now,
it.
Gina.
That's
yes.
You you like her head massages. You like when she throws things. Is that?
Hey. You can always tell what she ate recently.
Why?
Smell or because
it's
on
the
floor.
It's on the counter. It's on her face. I don't know.
She takes out a lot of aggression on like a
no,
lot of things.
No, cat's food is only on her face whenever it's like dessert. Whenever cat eats dessert, it's all over her face.
I didn't know you were a messy eater.
No, the other day when you ate the like two donuts, it literally was like
a 3-year-old on my head. Because I'm not allowed to have sugar, so when I do, it's like a special treat.
Her mom never let her.
I'm what we call crazy.
Oh, wow.
You realize you're a grown up now.
I forget sometimes.
I know. Like you, she when
she beats her friends. She's not a grown up yet.
The first time she drove to my house, she was going 55 and had her hands at 10 and 2. And when she got there, 20 minutes after me, I'm like, "Why did you take so long?" She's like, "My dad told me I'm not allowed to speed on the interstate."
I'm like, "Oh, when I see her, she is perched up on the edge
right.
and literally locked in.
Yeah.
It's amazing."
Oh yeah, you see me when you drive by, I roll down the window and yell out a certain word.
Well, it's your nickname.
Yeah.
So she's a messy eater. Interesting. You're so like she claims to be a very cleanly person.
I can attest to that.
All right.
When you have help like you going around
sweeping up after me. Here's the thing. I thought you guys would say, "I love how caring she is. She has a kind heart. She always brightens my day." And it's she's messy. Gets food all.
No, we asked their favorite thing. I'm sure they actually all love you and think that. Except Gina. You should see the scowl on her face.
She always looks like that.
Like,
yeah,
Gina, low-key, you should lock your door tonight, Kat. This bitch about to cut you.
No, I really just look like this all the time.
Oh, okay, alright, okay.
I get that a lot.
It's not the expression, it's the outfit.
She's wearing a nightgown.
She's wearing a muumuu, basically.
Coffee and donuts.
It's not a muumuu. She works at a place where she gets really dirty by a bunch of, like, germ hosts.
Yes,
thank you for explaining.
Basically, what we walked into was you think, all right, yeah, Greg, we're going to hang out with some sorority girls in Muncie. We're going to hang out at their house. It's going to be so hot. Walk in. One doesn't have deodorant on. One doesn't have a bra on.
I'm sitting next to her. She doesn't.
Right. One's in a nightgown, in like a pink nightgown, and then the other's Kat. I mean, we're...
Hey!
It's really a letdown, man.
She works out in her jeans.
Now, Gina, what is your major?
Boys, be nice. Is this a problem?
I think it's amazing. My mom's a social worker.
Thank you. So is my mom.
It takes a village. Hillary Clinton.
That is not what you said in chat. Say what you really
think. Yeah, say what you really
Well, I just don't think that you should get a degree for going around and giving change to black people.
Oh, God.
No.
I'm totally joking, Gina. I got your expression to change.
She literally was... There was a blizzard on that couch.
I know. I'm totally kidding. Totally kidding. So I understand it's about self-empowerment and helping them use the tools to move up the social mobility ladder.
But why
totally
do you like poor people so much?
I just feel like they need help, and I feel like I could give that to them. I've always, like, felt... Okay, it's
you gotta
funny
keep
that
it like
you
this.
Say, oh, sorry.
There you go.
It's funny that you say that, actually, because when I was little, like, little,
you hated
poor
people?
No. I loved them. And I wanted to, like, take them home with me, and, like, I would always ask my parents for money. But, like, that was, like, before I knew to, like, even give them money or that they were, like, homeless. And my mom was like, "You should be a social worker, you know?" Because, like, no one does that. Like,
no, they'd rather give it to a not-for-profit so they don't have to see it.
Right. But I was just, like, walking the streets of Chicago, like, "Hi,
are you from Chicago?
I haven't changed." Yeah, well.
Or Schaumburg, that's right.
Schaumburg,
sorry,
my parents grew up in Chicago. So
okay.
We went there all the time when I was little.
A lot of people help.
Yes, a lot.
No, I'm serious.
A lot of people.
No, like I've been detoured through like East Chicago on a Friday night, and it was stunning. It's not. It doesn't look like America.
We accidentally got off on. We were in our Lincoln Town Car when we were kids that my dad had, and we accidentally ended up in South Chicago.
Yeah.
And my dad was like, "Just get down! Don't make a move." I mean, it was bad.
Yeah, you make a wrong turn and.
Well, I mean, the real thing that got me is, like, how could you focus on anything other than staying alive? You know what I mean? Like, you can't even, like, think about things like, what do I want to do with my life? Like,
yeah.
You don't have that luxury.
That's, like, not even an option.
Yeah, it's like, how do I not get shot?
Or, like, not, like, freezing to death in the winter or
Yeah,
something.
Like, survival's a real thing. It's not like a, you know, a white people hiking and getting lost thing.
Yeah.
That TV is an LB TV.
It was a first generation flat screen.
You guys are so poor you can't even afford an LG. You had to get the LB.
Well, I found it in my basement. I didn't want to buy a new one.
Yeah.
Does it work?
Yeah. I mean, it's alright.
They watched Jersey Shore and it's so old it's not in
HD.
Multiple
hours of Jersey Shore.
Yeah.
All right, so,
we're not very materialistic here.
So,
oh, really, Crate and Barrel?
That's all
granite countertops, college student? Or not materialistic.
Literally, granite countertops in this place.
Yeah.
The nicest shower you've ever seen. I mean, this place is really nice.
Also, you guys bong beers in the shower? You too?
Well, yeah, so we don't spill it.
That makes sense. It's just,
that's
kind of genius.
Sticky.
Yeah.
Here's the amount of things that go, like, you wouldn't believe the amount of things that happen in a young college girl's shower. Like, they're on their phone.
I've seen the movies.
Like,
that's so true.
You're all on your phone the whole time.
You're pre-gaming in the shower.
Well, yeah.
That's so real.
A shower beer.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And it, like, or a nice glass of wine in the shower.
You do wine at your age?
Oh, yeah.
Really?
Everybody boxed wine.
Yeah.
You gotta,
slap
the bag. Yeah, exactly.
What else do you guys do in the shower? Like knit?
Play games.
Okay. Really?
Dance.
You're not worried about ruining your phone?
I dance in the shower.
Well, you don't hold it under the stream. You hold it out of the stream.
Okay.
But the idea that, like, you just can't be that disconnected from your phone is crazy to me.
Honestly, I know what shocks me. Like, people get that, like, anxiety from not being able to check notifications.
That's real.
If they haven't heard the beep, they, like, go ahead and check it to make sure it's still got connection.
So here's the thing. Like, how old are you, Jordan?
20.
How old are you, Gina?
20.
Kat?
20.
And you're?
21.
Oh, yeah. High five. Buying all the beer.
Great success.
Hey, I'm almost there.
Almost there. You got, like, 3 months?
Yeah, 2.5.
Are you excited to have your first drink?
Very excited.
Excellent. Do you have plans for your 21st already?
Yeah, and you'll be here.
She's going to set up a tent and get high as a motherfucker.
We'll be having the 21st birthday in Muncie, Indiana. The Wall Friends will be colliding with...
We're going to go to the downtown bars. Is that, like, nightclub? Like that?
Yeah, but I thought we'd just go to the Village. I mean, it's like a Wednesday night, so I figured most people wouldn't even want to go anyways.
Is there a good townie bar? We'll go get some PBR.
Yeah.
Oh, God.
Now, Gina, are you excited to be 21 and drink? Are you much of a drinker?
I am excited, but it's not till March.
Oh, that's a long haul.
Jordan?
She's the same way, right?
My birthday's not till May.
Yeah.
Oh,
young.
The last
time
we
were being.
Right as school ends, God, you have the worst 21st ever.
The week after graduation.
If you guys were real friends, you would stay the additional time. So she.
Well, we're not.
Definitely. No, you
better
be staying.
Well, we're not. So.
Now, Jordan, where? What? Like, how far away from here are you? Like, what town did you grow up in, essentially?
Indianapolis, like Greenwood area.
Oh, okay. Yeah, she lives literally like 5 minutes from the Wall Studios.
Yeah.
So,
yeah.
Which is what we call my apartment.
It's very lovely.
The Poon Palace.
Gina, you're welcome to come over to the studios anytime you'd like.
Well.
Nice.
So I'm a frequenter, though.
That's what we call an in-real-life DM.
Yeah. I just slide up in her DMs. I know the other two have boyfriends. Do you have a boyfriend?
I do not.
Oh, she does not.
Hey, Spangle, what
you
about
sure?
Me?
Want to go with that?
You're like my little sister. I can't have sex with you.
Well, not according to the porn you watch.
That's very true.
Your mom would have to marry her dad.
Yeah, honestly, like, stepsister porn is where it's at.
Oh, God.
Right?
Relatable.
Kate, I mean, honestly.
Just before you got here.
Right. Katie knows what you're talking about.
My boyfriend, we actually grew up together.
So Katie, why are you going into social work?
My mom is a social worker. I actually didn't even start as a social work major. I started as an education major.
Did you go on probation by the sorority?
I didn't.
That must be hard. I bet that doesn't happen a lot.
It's rare.
You gotta get that mic like this.
Oh, man.
Remember, girls, like a certain activity. That's how you get close. You gotta have it close.
Pretend it's your stepbrother.
I say that because you won't forget now. You won't forget to keep that.
You're doing that.
Now, Katie, keep going. So
yeah, my mom was a social work major, and my brother worked in a behavioral health unit for a while, and I watched how they were working with a lot of different communities of people. And
diverse?
Yes, very diverse. Mm-hmm. And I really liked that.
Greg's first concern.
Yes.
Were there others?
Yes.
From out of
town? People of different kinds. Yes.
All the colors of the rainbow.
And I just really wanted to get involved with that and see what I could do. And I
assuage your white guilt.
Exactly.
I'm totally kidding. I'm totally joking. I don't mean any of this. No. It is really, though, it's not like...
I could never...
It's not a profession. It's like a mission or a calling. Like the
priest. Yeah, that's how my mom...
Actually, elementary ed is totally that way, the way
the
Indiana education
is. Because your sister's an elementary
ed. Yeah, and it is not at all like it used to be.
It's just insane, like, you know, they all talk about, like, the classes that they're doing and the stuff they're learning about, and it's just... You know, like, yeah, we make fun of them because it's funny to be like, oh, you're nice to poor people, because, like, it's so awful to say. But in reality, like, I'm just shocked and, like, very proud of them for
being. Oh, yeah.
I could never do that. I could never do that. And it's just
way
insane.
Too vain.
Oh, for sure. And, like, 99.9% of the population is too vain to do that as well.
Oh, absolutely.
So to be that selfless is
really,
incredible.
Yeah, like, I really do believe both those kind of, like, elementary ed and social are callings.
Gina, what kind of classes do you take for social? What year are you?
I'm a junior.
Okay,
we're
so
all juniors.
You're a junior.
All
right.
Are you all?
Yes.
And you you take what kind of classes?
I'm taking all social work classes, so it's just like different kinds of social work, and then I take classes for my minor as well.
Now listen, I, of course, being incredibly intelligent and good looking, as you can tell, I know what social work is and what social work classes are, but pretend I'm a baby and I don't know what you're talking about. What define social work and the kind of classes that you take?
We learn, like, I don't know how to describe it. Like, it's like helping, like...
Bums.
Building
tent cities 101.
And you feel free to jump in here too anytime, Katie.
What's that word? Like,
we're both in, like, a generalist practice, like, social work class. Mm-hmm. So we're learning a lot about, like, self-help groups.
Empowerment.
How to conduct those.
Where to find the resources.
Yeah,
and
different therapy techniques if we ever want to go into, like, get our clinical social work license.
You probably will want to, won't you?
Yeah, I mean, we're both trying to get our master's, like, right after.
Isn't it amazing you have to have a master's in social work to get, like, a $12 to $15 an hour job?
Yeah, my mom just finished her, like, LSW test and her master's program, and she's, like, 50 years old, so.
Yep.
It's crazy.
You have to really be committed.
Yeah.
We also take, like, policy and research classes.
Those would be the really interesting ones.
Yeah.
The effectiveness.
Yeah,
of
social welfare
techniques.
Classes.
Yeah.
Because poverty is not just, you know, the absence of money. Like, it can be cultural. There's a lot of different
aspects.
Yeah,
yeah. There's a lot of different aspects.
The statistics are, like, insane.
Yeah.
Right.
Because,
like, what you hear is, like, the white Republicans saying, they just need to get a job and work hard. And then you go to East Chicago on a Friday night, you're like,
and it's like,
I don't think it works like that.
So, like, what kind of statistics, Katie?
Just, like, the different, like, groups of people or, like,
demographics.
How, like, varies based on, like just women. And then you add, like, an African-American woman. And then it just, like, changes so vastly. And, like, it really depends on what group you're working with. Like, if you're talking about, like, substance abuse or poverty or, like, battered women. It's just, like, crazy to see those, like, numbers vary so much. Or, like, suicide rates. Like, I always think that one is, like, just
stunning.
So insane.
Mm. I mean, what other things, what have you been surprised about as you kind of go through the social work stuff?
I think, like, surprises are that, like, you can't, like, really, like, all you can do is kind of, like, be there and, like, kind of just, like, give, like, resources. And then, like, kind of realizing, like, all the resources that are there, but, like, also PU saying, like, all of the different, like, aspects that go into it. Like, it's so much bigger than just, like, you or, like, a certain type of, like, practice even.
How do you feel about, like, you can't make someone walk through the door? You know, you can show them the door, but they have to walk through it. And to watch that, like, all regress after how much you've invested in the person would be tough to not take home.
Yeah. No, definitely.
Have you guys, because I have a friend that, a really good friend who's a social worker who works at a school with elementary age kids, and I met her when she was going through her master's and now as she's working, and she's very careful to kind of put that bridge between her personal life and her work and not bring that home. I mean, I imagine both of you got into this, and Jordan, you too, you got into it because you're empathetic people.
Well, you mainstreamed Kat in your sorority, which is incredible.
Right.
Exactly. Here's the thing, they're all the loving, kind, compassionate, empathetic people, and I'm the asshole.
Right.
So.
She's signing autographs after the podcast.
Yeah, actually.
Literally.
You told me to, it's not
your
fault.
It's not your fault. I will never, girls, you can never, ladies, I didn't mean to assume your age. Now, Katie, You couldn't believe how big her eyes got last week after the podcast when I said, can you autograph these posters?
Would you take a picture?
She was so excited.
I would put it on social media.
Well, you guys make me sound very vain. I feel like I'm humble. Maybe I'm not. You guys can attest to that. Am I cocky?
No, because... That's a lie. No, because you always want, like, opinions and reassurance on whatever you're doing. Like, you always ask us, like, how am I doing? Am I doing okay? Like, you want to know what people think before you're like, I'm really awesome.
Yeah, exactly. No, you're not vain. Like, you do have vanity, but you are...
But everybody does.
I feel like, if anything, I wish you had more confidence. So.
I don't second that at all. We'll stay right there.
Now,
in the cook.
Jordan, how did you end up deciding to become an elementary educator?
In like high school, I used to teach dance classes to like younger kids, so I've always liked being around kids, and teaching is fun.
Right.
Honestly, I get so excited when I get on Instagram and I like look at people's classrooms and like how they color code things. Honestly, it's the coolest thing ever.
Yeah, she color codes my planner all the time.
Honestly, she's into the discipline, is what she's saying. She got into teaching
yes.
to discipline people.
Exactly.
No, teach them structure.
Yeah.
Because like exactly. honestly, I was so impressed coming to a group of college girls' house. Your level of organization is amazing. You have. Like a place for keys, so when you're shit-faced stumbling in, you can just throw them.
Yep.
And then you assign chores like with clips.
Yeah.
It's
very bougie.
Yeah. What is that like a really bourgeois, like a shortened bourgeois?
Yeah.
Is that popular?
Like,
is that what the young kids say? Oh,
it's
bad
like a bunch of songs.
Yeah.
Like.
Mean drop, drop
right.
top.
So, I mean, I guess I don't understand it because the idea of I'm a very empathetic person. But being around people who are in trouble or people who are not fully developed yet would drive me absolutely out of my mind because, not because I would want to take every puppy, no, you don't need to go to the pound, come home with me, you know, that sort of attitude where I would carry it with me. I mean, how much thought have you guys put into that? I mean, do you sit there and say, I'm going into social work, I'm going into elementary ed, which I think is interesting that they're going into... very caring, nurturing, social, and this is a point that a lot of, this is part of the gender discussion that goes on, is that men are more attracted to the accountant, to the IT, to more of those
the
analytical
INTJ.
Job, the INTJ spectrum, whereas women are more attracted to the social work. That's part of why the wage gap exists, is because women are attracted to more lower income jobs because they take care of people, and men are attracted to more higher earning jobs like management and...
And my big question would be, is that a cultural expectation that's just existed for years,
yeah.
or is it an actual, you know, natural event, or biological
right.
event?
I 100% think both.
Do you?
Like, and
well, yeah,
I'm like,
it's never either or.
Yeah, no, I 100% think it's, like, both just, like, who I am as a person, and because of the way that we perceive women,
yeah.
and how they're supposed to act.
Right, I mean, everyone has roles that, you know,
yeah.
you're born and you immediately are... have roles thrust upon
yeah,
you, so
exactly.
you can't ever really break free.
No, exactly.
But, so...
I mean, if you hate your sibling, you just want to be like, I am not your sister.
Yeah.
So...
kind of
explain that a little bit more. I mean, you... Go ahead.
Like, the way...
I don't want to talk over you,
the way we perceive women? Is that...
Are you yeah.
you talk about?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I definitely think that, like... Especially, I'm a sociology minor.
Mm-hmm.
So... Greg, be nice. No, you're fine.
You're doing good.
So I'm a social work major and sociology minor, so I'm constantly just, like, learning about, like, different populations and how they function and what their roles are in life and all that those things. And, you know, like, women is a huge thing, especially, like, in our recent, like, political
right.
climate
realm. That
just, I don't know what you mean. What are you referring to?
I think you know what I mean. that we just... perceive women to be like sitting back and take on that nurturing role and
the expectation
yeah,
of subservience,
which is like fine, like, and there's like the whole nature versus nurture, like, which is I talk about all the time in my classes, like,
mm-hmm.
and I just think that's really interesting, and I know like I know I have like maternal instincts, and I know that's just because of like the way our culture has like pushed that
sure.
on me.
Or did God make you that way?
I mean, you never know.
You have a rib of mine, and I'd like it back.
I mean, what did you three, Kat?
Yeah, how do you guys
Gina,
feel about
I mean,
because college is where you really go through these things.
Let me pose it to you. The gender roles, I mean, it's such a huge discussion at every area of society, but especially, you know, I would imagine on a college campus.
Oh, yeah.
I didn't even realize, like, there were gender roles and that I was being, you know...
forced into one?
Well, kind of being just a dick guy until about 3 or 4 years ago, and I wasn't as... because I was just doing what I was taught, and then I met a friend.
It changed
everything. Actually, Amanda's story, episode 144, really, she kind of said, you know, you talk to me this way, and it makes me feel this way, and it's very demeaning towards women. And I was like, oh, well, I don't want to be that guy. So so it helped me kind of restructure a lot, and you hear that in that episode. I think Kat can attest that Dear Leader provides. He's very nurturing.
Yeah, that's the thing is, Dear Leader, like, you know.
Me.
Yes, Dear Leader, let's be real. Oh, I think I've explained this to my roommates, but our entire show is based on a totalitarian regime.
Right. Okay. I'm the dictator of this podcast.
It's his world, we just live in.
Yes, he is Dear Leader, the most supreme.
Mandatory freedom, Katie.
Mandatory freedom. And Greg, you are the...
I don't know, but...
Diversity?
Chief
Diversity Officer. Yeah, Diversity and Outreach Coordinator.
Right. Scat Cat,
our recruitment numbers, you should probably talk to me. Impressive.
Right, and I'm Scat Cat, Pop Star of Liberty.
But as a guy, I'm much more sensitive and emotional than I think people realize, and much more caring and nurturing, and I think that has hurt me in a lot of different aspects of my life, because I'm not...
Right.
A dick.
Well, and we've had this discussion, too, is that... Women, you know, especially, like, people our age, when you go online or whatever, they talk about, you know, they share all those posts from the Odyssey online. You know what mm-hmm. I'm talking about? Where, ladies, date a guy who treats you like this. Marry a guy who treats you like this. And the articles list out every good thing that you guys are.
Right.
But women don't like that.
Right.
Because they're programmed to like a challenge or whatever.
Basically, cold and distant stepfather. This is the best way.
That's what I've always told you to do.
Yep.
Never get praised.
The Greg
withhold everything.
The Greg strategy towards women, as he once put it, is the mushroom strategy.
Oh, get down.
He didn't come up with this.
It's from the movie The Departed.
Keep them
in the dark.
Women
feed
are
them
like
shit.
Women are like mushrooms. Keep them in the dark and feed them shit. And you probably have run into your fair share of guys like that.
Oh yeah, especially living on a college campus.
Absolutely.
Yeah. You walk into a frat house and that's like.
Cis shitlords everywhere.
Yes.
Just frat and... It has to be the worst, right, Gina?
Right.
You're very vehement about this. You're very... You
there's have a vendetta against the whole Greek system.
Like, she's very... She's like, I'm going to tell men what I think of them in her face. I can see it.
Right?
No, but being more sensitive... And I've learned to, over time, kind of just shut that part of myself off because... It is less attractive in general, being more of, I don't want to say a feminine man, but somebody who is more in touch. As an ENFJ, much more in touch with people and their moods and their feelings
right.
and their
intuitive
needs.
Intuitive and perceptive.
Yeah,
and like I've said, the deepest conversations that I've ever had in my life were with you
right.
this summer. I've never had that amount of, like, not in a weird way, but like intimate conversations with somebody.
I mean, we were snuggling and looking in each other's eyes the whole time.
Watching Hitler documentaries.
Right. Watching Hitler documentaries. Right, exactly.
It was a bonding thing. Very, a lot of feels.
There's nothing weird about it.
Nothing weird about it. I
was wearing a cape and nothing else. There was nothing weird.
Not all heroes, Chris.
There were tassels and a glutathione. That was you.
Right. There were nipple clamps involved. But
that's progressive.
Mittens was very upset about
yeah.
it.
That's his cap.
Yeah. But yeah, the... See?
Gina whispers, I love cats.
Yeah.
Now she's wearing a nightgown.
Oh,
yeah.
She's going to live in a shoe.
So do you, like, what's your take on gender roles being a social work major? I mean, there's so much of the, you know, we need to abolish all gender roles and everybody needs to be completely equal. And then there's all the way to, like, Greg, where, you know, men are men and they should be like John Wayne and women are... You know, property.
I feel like people just need to be, like, more educated on the subject matter, and there's a lot of double standards and a lot of, like, gray areas, mm-hmm. and I feel like some are just, like, slippery slopes, you know, like, you can take it way too far on either end.
Right.
So,
everything
like
reduced to the absurd.
Yeah, that's true, but I feel like especially with, like, gender roles and stuff, like, I feel like certain things are, like, appropriate, like, you know, like, there are certain things that are just, like, there are masculine.
Right.
Or, like, there are certain, like, feminine qualities, and, like, that's totally fine to have, but then, like, when people, like, take it a step, like, I don't know, it's just, like, very hard.
Like, there's extremists in every movement that ruin it for the rest of us.
Exactly.
The militant feminazis ruin it for people who just want what your natural traits are to be on the same playing field as what the more masculine.
Well, also in some things, too, like, it just can't be. Like, men, like, are, you know, like, built different, they're biologically different, like
chromosome
levels. That is literally proven.
Our brains are bigger. It's science. Look it up. The fact that you don't know that shows.
Now, Jordan, like, how do you feel? Do you think any of that role this played a role at all in choosing elementary ed? Because, like, my sister works with almost entirely females.
I mean, yeah, kind of. The majority of, there's probably one class, elementary education class that I have that has one guy in it.
Yeah.
And that's it.
Interesting.
And, like, is he viewed as an oddity? Or does it, do people say, oh, you know, the guy?
No, definitely. People, like, call him out. Every time they, like, ask a question about anything that's, like, opinion related, they always ask four girls, and they're like, oh, well, you're a guy, so what do you think about this?
Right. Yeah. Do you ever call him out for just forcing gender roles on him?
Does he scream out, how dare you assume my gender?
No, he doesn't. But, I mean,
I'm a peacock. Let me fly. No, but he doesn't get upset?
I don't think so. I mean, he's in the class of all girls. Of course he's going to get called out.
Honestly, like, isn't that the best strategy?
That's
victim
shaming.
No, that's like, if you're
he's
a guy,
no,
yeah,
no,
yes.
no, absolutely not.
You're a guy.
Because you experience like too much of their inner.
That's good.
No, it's like it's too close. You're too close to it.
But see, here's the difference.
It's a fast lane to the friend zone.
Here's the difference between you and me. I like that stuff. You
feminine products.
All of them. They're thinking. They're.
Oh, I was talking about, you know.
The periods.
Things that are like grenade and go away.
You know, the blood coming out of Katie's wherever.
The wherever. Megyn Kelly's wherever.
So do you guys have just crazy SJW social justice warrior people, like, that literally everything is offensive and awful?
Yeah, definitely. I took a sociology of, like, gender class.
I'm in that right now.
Yeah, like, last semester. And
fiction?
It's
creative writing?
And it's it was like a large lecture. There's probably like 100 kids in it, and like my teacher like was amazing. She always remained unbiased, like never let people know like what side she was kind of like on. Especially because I took it during the time of our most recent election.
God Emperor Trump.
And
came to make us great again.
Yeah. So she never like revealed kind of what side she was on. She always just let people speak how they wanted. And people really took advantage of that.
Oh,
like,
yeah.
Like, people were not afraid to be, like, especially when we were talking about, like, sex and all those kind of things and, like, how women are expected to have sex, but, like, they have to be a whore and a saint at the same time.
Yeah, Madonna.
Yeah.
Yeah,
complex. You know what I'm talking about? And girls were just, like, there was a girl who sat right in the front, and she was, like, yeah, like, oh, I have a story, like, you know, me and my boyfriend, we were, like, having an orgy this weekend, and everybody's just like, oh, like,
right.
TMI.
Definitely.
Hold on, just a second. I just had to turn on Cat's mic. So,
no, you didn't.
That's I had to pause briefly to turn on Cat's mic.
Thank you.
Yeah, but it's still not on, so
really?
Yeah.
Test, one, two.
Keep talking.
Check, 1, 2, how am I sounding? Good.
Pop it twice.
Keep talking.
Pop.
There we go.
Good.
Yep, all right.
So Kat was in your class and talked about the orgy she had.
Could you imagine Kat in an orgy?
Well, I'm attracted to those, right? Hey guys, pew pew pew.
Well, I was ready to go until you double finger gunned me.
Now I feel like I'm watching A League of Their Own.
Hey, it's better to be like, so for the racetrack, for the Indy 500, the cars are built upside down like airplanes.
No, you didn't.
I did.
Kat, I wouldn't attack me because there are 1, 2, 3 of your roommates here that will, at the drop of a hat, give me embarrassing information about you.
No, they wouldn't.
Hey, and I like the Indy 500. It's pretty cool, man.
What is it like? What is Kat like when she flirts with a boy?
It's actually awesome to see her flirt with a boy because she's completely like herself. And then when she finds somebody who's like her too, it's so cool because they're just like weird, and
they just like vibe really.
You know what I mean? Like
she's
always
vibing.
I love it.
She's
yeah.
always vibing.
Yeah.
Meaning when cool, I go to a homeless shelter and volunteer.
Tell me more about your farm. I don't care that you don't have a car.
That was me being nice, yeah, Craig.
Yeah, names.
You should try it sometime.
Where should we meet on the corner next time?
Hey, you better be nice to me because you're gonna be my date.
It's gonna be fun.
That's true.
Yeah. So
your roommate's great.
We'll,
really fun.
We'll all be there. Get, probably getting ratchet.
Yeah.
It was pretty ratchet last year.
Absolutely. It's gonna be
like,
a good
time.
Like, so for your 21st birthday, you guys can't go out though. Unfortunately.
I'm not going. I wasn't invited, Greg.
You're going to the one out right after.
I'm just saying.
It's
me
a
out.
Greeks only. It's like a closed prom. We got a playing field.
I'm Greek.
No, you're not. You're German. You tried to invade my country.
Yep.
And
very true.
And we won.
We made it great again.
Right.
All
right. Okay, so back to gender roles. And so the crazy SJW. So everybody got real free in that
class. Your
class
had to be full of that, because that's the kind of class they flocked to.
And when I told stories on the podcast, it was from her telling me the story.
She's your source. Well, I mean, you don't find, like, the radical stories very often.
Right. No, but yeah.
She's my deep throat.
I took it.
It's a quote from her.
I took that class, like first semester of last year, so right during the campaign.
Heaven, I would have had so much
that
fun.
That class was so controversial the whole time. Like, it was honestly, like, I had anxiety just sitting there the whole time. Because it was,
hostile.
People would scream at each other.
That's the current environment,
and
the
teacher's just trying to remain so unbiased, and she's like, yeah, I really like your opinion. And she's like, just trying to power through it, and everybody's just like, but it sucked kind of being in that class because, you know, I'm the kind of person, I like to hear all sides of,
right,
like, all different opinions, like,
then form your own
before I, like, validate my opinion.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, being on a college campus, it's a lot of liberal opinions.
Right.
And in some ways, I do think I have a liberal opinion on some things, but in other things, I'm, like, still unsure about. And if, like, someone gave a conservative opinion, they were
mm-hmm.
immediately attacked, which
right.
was, like, unfair because nobody was attacking the liberal opinion.
Sure.
Which is...
But usually the liberal... Everyone knows the conservative opinion usually. Because, I mean, that's what most of our country is.
Yeah.
And
you
know, culturally,
I feel it's almost like a rebellion against their parents.
And they don't ever hear the radical idea. Like, you know, the second wave of U.S. feminism was the idea of community child rearing. Like,
yeah.
So, you know, that was Geraldine Greer. And, like, there was this rise of radical Berkeley ideas that challenged everything... The conservatives need to be challenged too.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they need to have their ideas
exactly.
challenged, or you get nothing else.
Exactly.
Know.
Yeah.
Have you ever read, anyone ever read The Feminine Mystique?
Mm-hmm.
No. No? Have you taken any feminism classes?
I didn't.
What did you think?
I told you, didn't I take class? I don't remember.
You have to an extent, but I didn't know how, like, what the course specifically focused around.
Yeah, well, it was just a women and gender studies class.
Okay, so women's studies intro?
Yeah, pretty much. I thought it was interesting, but, like, I think I talked about it on the podcast.
Yeah.
You weren't listening.
well, you're a woman.
Right, exactly. No, I don't know.
I wanted an opinion I'd ask your boyfriend.
Right, exactly. No.
Guess you can't give any opinions.
No, it's just one of those things where, you know, you're fed the liberal opinion the entire time, which is fine because, like, Katie, I like hearing both sides as well. But it's to the point where even this summer when people, you know, SNL makes fun of Trump so much, it's hack.
Right.
It's not funny anymore. Because it's so overdone.
It's like the making fun of Melania wearing the shoes to Texas, the high heels to Texas in the flood. Like, if you posted about her wearing high heels to a flood, that you literally have nothing going on in your life, nothing better going on, and you just start to look so ridiculous that people tune you out. Like, it isn't...
It's counterproductive.
It is. It becomes so over the top in the criticism that people... It's the boy who cried wolf.
And when we're, like, talking about politics nowadays, I feel like we're not even talking about the political issues.
No.
We're talking just about who the people are.
Yeah.
And it's, like, such an attack on their character because, like, I mean, I don't know, like, who's in office. Like, I don't know them personally. I want to know their political ideals.
If you had read Bill Clinton's 1991 campaign book to get ready for him for president, we did on a show.
Mm-hmm.
It is arguably more conservative than Donald Trump's agenda.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You know, America first, protections for labor unions.
Welfare reform.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, his welfare reform is the greatest conservative accomplishment in modern American history.
So, on my day job, we have a comedian on named Miss Pat. Ms. Pat is hilarious. We're gonna have.
She thought that remake of Birth of a Nation was real though. She thought Nat Turner actually got turned into oil. Remember that conversation?
No, Ms. Pat's gonna
inform her.
Ms. Pat asked if she could come on the show.
So what's happening?
She's going to come on the show pretty soon. She's a scream. She just wrote a book called Rabbit. And I asked her how she ended up in stand-up comedy. And she said it is because of welfare work. She said, Bill Clinton told me that I could get off welfare if I got a job, and then he helped me get out of it. And that's an example of a government program helping people.
That's what everything you guys study. Because that's like, you know, what do they call the golden triangle of like public policy?
Yeah.
Where, you know, it limits expenditure, it gets them out of poverty. With that, what was it, earned income tax credit was successful with that?
I mean, have you, you two, Gina and Jordan, have you two run into, like, the crazy SJW types? Like, what do you think of them?
Oh, yeah.
Or are you one of them?
I am not.
You seem more radical than her.
Yeah.
What do you mean?
Like, do you guys disagree on much?
Did you?
No, me and Katie normally have, like, I feel like
we don't talk politics in the house.
No, not really.
No, we don't.
Thank God for you, or you'd be voted out.
Katie and I have, like, very, very similar views on basically everything.
Yeah.
How many I'm with her t-shirts do you own?
Zero.
Katie?
None.
We're Bernie, not bros.
Cat?
Three.
Would you get this?
You own the Hillary Clinton outfit.
Yeah, that's true.
Would Natalie disown you if you wore an I'm with her t-shirt?
No. Honestly, no. Mm-mm. I really don't think she would now.
Yeah.
No.
No. She'd be okay with it. But radical SJWs in your classes, Gina?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, what are they like?
They just feel like their opinion needs to be, like, not even heard, but just, like,
given precedence.
It needs to be, like, screamed.
Yeah.
And they, like, deserve a promotion.
Also, they, like to use, like, profanity. Like, they can't just say, like, oh, like, a guy will come on to a girl. It'll be like, yeah, a guy's going to stick his penis in my mouth. I'm like, well, Jesus. Like, you did not have to say that. Like, it's like
forced entry.
Yeah, like, it's crazy. Like, they just, like, take it, like, a step farther.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And it's just, it makes it, like, 10 times more aggressive.
And it makes, like, people like me and Jordan and Gina, who are, like, social work majors and elementary ed majors, and people who study, like, women and gender studies, it makes us, like, when we tell people, like, they're like, oh.
Well, that's counterproductive again.
Yeah. And
vulgarity never works well.
Yeah, again, because the extremists. Like, ruin it.
It also makes it hard for people to understand where, like, anybody other than normal is coming from, because, like, I'm not saying that anybody isn't normal or there is whatever, but, like, there people take everything, like we said, to an extreme. So it's hard for people who, I mean, like, they're not fully educated on it, obviously, but they don't get it because they're,
they can't get past the shock value.
Right. Mm-hmm. But, like, it's to an extent that's understandable because it's taken very far sometimes.
See, and that's what I think is the most interesting thing is, and we've talked about this on the show before, is how people are, those who are part of the left, I guess you could just say, those who are part of the left are so angry about the extremists and they preach.
It's the oppression they just feel like constantly.
Right, and they preach, you know, don't listen to them, listen to us. Yeah. However, when it comes to the right, they believe the extremists.
Yeah.
Extremely intolerant.
Yeah.
Extremely.
Like, Charlottesville, I feel like, is really indicative of what exactly you're talking about. Like, I can't tell you the number of people that are, you know, suburban Republicans that are pretty much apolitical, that after Charlottesville, the only thing they took away was the militant radical leftists. And the thought of being with the people carrying, you know, on the same side of the argument with the swastika flag carrying individuals didn't really bother them all that much. It wasn't going to affect their voting behavior whatsoever.
Why aren't they going after Antifa? Why are they only going after the Nazis?
Right.
And I saw, like, a lot of that.
I mean, and I felt like, you know, a lot of it was inevitable because you're never going to get identity politics out of politics, ever. You know, it's just the way it is. But I've never seen such a hospitable climate for, on the right, you know, white nationalism.
Yeah.
Does it feel like we're all just kind of trapped in the middle?
I mean, Libertarian parties has felt like that for forever.
Yeah.
I mean, and they're just students, you know. But like I said before, is so many people I know, adults too, but a lot of students, are Libertarian without even knowing it.
Mm-hmm.
One time I was at camp, not one of my, you know, my Pence camps.
what do you mean?
You know, like, Pray the Gay Away camps, not one of those.
I thought they zapped you.
Zap the Gay Away, right. Not that camp. But one time I was at a camp, and one of our, like, counselors, I guess, is a black
as a black male, and he's like, went to Butler, extremely educated, mm-hmm. and we were all talking politics in the basement, and this was in like 2015, and some of the campers are now, they now go to like the bigger 10 schools mm-hmm. in the Midwest, and they are like complete Bernie Bros, SJWs to the core, and when they were talking with the black guy, he was, you know, talking about like, oh, I don't really agree with that, blah, 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 and I said, So-and-so, what is your political belief? And he said, oh, I'm a Democrat. I've always been a Democrat, always will. If people aren't Democrats, they're stupid. And I said, well, what do you believe? And he said, this, I kid you not, he said, well, I'm, you know, socially liberal, but I'm fiscally pretty conservative. And I said, so you're a libertarian. And I kid you not, this quote, educated quote, you know, the picture of what everyone should be like from the left, right, mm-hmm. looks at me and says, I'm a Democrat. I've always been a Democrat.
It's a brand, like a Lexus driver, or right. You know, like it very much is a sign of status and where your place is in society. I feel like, and I've always felt that way.
Yeah,
you know, it's not a play of what do I believe. It's a play of who do I like hanging out with, and what can they do for me in my career.
Exactly.
I mean, being young, and Kat helped reaffirm a lot of this because I've just seen her, like being around her and being a good friend to her as she's trying to figure out life at a young age. Like, the pressure to be quote-unquote normal and conform seems very, very intense in your early 20s. And
even physically detrimental if you're not on a college campus.
I remember the pressure to just, you know, it's like, Jordan, you're weird if you're not married by 26 and have a kid, right? Like, there's this...
What's wrong with you?
It just, there's so many societal standards that just seem like a lot of pressure as you're sorting all this stuff out.
Yeah. Agree.
Yeah.
What was it like in education classes this last year?
I mean, to be honest, we don't really talk about a lot of the like social issues in our classes because we're sitting here talking about, oh, like this is how you manage kids in the classroom. This is how you write a lesson plan. So we don't really ever get to talk about that in like elementary education classes. But
they didn't bring up like Betsy DeVoe or anything like that.
Not really. They try to steer away from it.
That's good.
Yeah, it's really good.
It gets like kind of brought up by someone, and then they.
The funding's a big, it should be always on the mind at most, because you're a publicly funded state school with someone that's appointing an education secretary who would privatize the whole thing and just hand out vouchers.
Right.
And in, you know, the majority of FAFSA, probably privatize Sallie Mae.
But it's,
you know.
Yeah, it sounds like you're just kind of insulated from the politics of everything.
Pretty much, yeah.
That's good. Where, Gina, you guys sound like you're swimming in the politics of
God
every day. Would you say?
Yeah, especially in our policy class, I would say, and in sociology a lot, because sociology
is... That's where the planners are, they want to fix everything.
Basically just, like, controversial views being, like, mm-hmm. talked about and, like, understood, I guess, but so, yeah.
Now, Gina, you shook your head violently when I said there's a lot of pressure to conform at your guys' age, and in college, I mean, why were you shaking your head?
Because, like, I believe that to be true, but I also believe that, like, you're not supposed to conform.
Non-conforming is the new conforming.
Yeah. And so it's extremely confusing, and you're supposed to, like, be your
own... I'm a snowflake!
...person in a world that's, like, trying to make you be like everyone else, but you're... It's, like, it's just very confusing.
How do you do it? Because what could you possibly choose that would make you unique nowadays? Exactly. That isn't just radically, and like, radically out of the bounds.
And now it's, you know, now it's not where, I guess you could say, quote, preppy was the normal... And art was the not normal.
Mm-hmm.
Well, now, quote, art is the normal. The Polaroid.
Glee's cool, and football's for losers.
Exactly. So it's just, I think it's just a constant shift. And another thing is, one of the other reasons why, of course, I adore them so much, another reason I really find it interesting to room with social work and education majors is because they're dealing with problems that we talk about on the podcast in a different way.
Yeah.
So for me, the way I deal with it in my major is because I'm the part that's reporting on it, mm-hmm. right? I'm studying how to report it and what...
The 10,000 foot view, kind of.
Exactly. So, that you know, they're dealing with things on the ground, and I'm dealing with reporting that to the rest of the world.
And
you're
getting
the
care, which is the hardest part.
Yeah, and it's all twisted, and it's all warped, so it's just very interesting.
I played in a golf outing, like, a couple weeks ago. It was for a battered woman's shelter, and the number of people that would write enormous checks but would not give 1 hour is alarming.
Yeah.
I mean, it's, and they don't even want the people who would benefit from it.
Say that again?
The amount of people that would write a huge check but not give 1 hour of volunteering was stunning. And I feel like that's why the rise of not-for-profits is really taking off, because people care about poverty so long as they don't have to see it.
Yeah. And I talked to somebody who runs a nonprofit the other day, and they said, I would rather people donate than volunteer, because people show up.
Oh, like, I agree, because it's done by professionals.
Well, he said, people show up, they hang out, they take selfies, they appear that they're volunteering, and then they never actually do anything, and then they never come back.
Yeah.
And so I need money, because then I can just hire people like Katie or Gina, who are going to come in and are training
and
professionals.
Yeah, and then, you know, they have the philosophical training behind it of why they do what they're doing, as well as this is the trenches that I have to show up and do every day.
Yeah, no, my mom, she's a social worker. She works with caregivers and, like, people who have dementia and Alzheimer's and things like that. And she's, like, you know, like, reached out to her friends and, like, people she knows to, like, help her volunteer. And she says it's, like, the worst idea she's ever done. She was like, I would rather people just write me a check, because once they get there, they're uncomfortable. It makes me look bad. It makes my organization look bad. And it's just...
They go, why do you keep asking me that?
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, they just do the...
Yeah.
Because they don't know.
Yeah.
Not that they're mean-spirited.
No, it's just...
Interesting.
So, I mean, like, I would feel pretty good if I were you guys. The only thing I don't like for you guys, for actually any of you... is one, the amount of debt you burden. I don't know anyone's financial situation, but you know, your generation is really up a creek with the college debt burden.
I mean, we're millennials.
It's indentured servitude for a very long time.
Millennials definitely had it. That's why we're less entrepreneurial, and Gen Z, I would think,
even more so.
Even more so.
I mean, right. College hasn't gone down. You know, prices don't go down in college.
Right.
And you know, living expenses don't go down. Because I mean, if you think about it, what you guys pay for this house could buy four of them on the block if it was just a mortgage.
Right.
But what you pay in rent, you know, since because of the lack of supply, is stunning difference.
Yeah.
And you did almost burn it down, so justifiably so.
I mean, honestly, Gina, over a turkey.
Arson is so overdone.
Our landlord doesn't know.
You had four fire trucks come, and you put it on social media, and he doesn't know.
Jordan, yeah. Don't tell Silver Daddy.
So hot.
He would not be very happy with us.
No.
What do you get? Never mind.
Oh boy.
Anyways, thank you for listening.
So, how much of your, like, I don't really remember thinking much about money when I was choosing a college or going to college, because I knew it was going to cost a lot, and I just got loans, and, like, it's just now at 33 that I'm starting to pay the
principal.
Like, yeah. I mean, I just deferred.
Oh, it's like a credit card. Why is that balance going up?
Right. How much did money factor into your guys' decision making when you started looking into colleges?
A lot for me, because I'm the youngest of like three kids, so I have an older brother and an older sister. And you know, being the youngest, you get to watch your siblings like make all the decisions.
Mistakes.
You kind of just observe it. And my brother and sister both went to college out of state. And I watched my dad being the only one working in the house while my mom was also in college trying to get her master's while he was sending two kids to universities in another state.
And a master's then, for social work, no
less. Yeah. And then sending me to a private high school. So by the time I got to college, I was like, both my siblings had graduated, and I was like, you know, I don't want to do that to my parents again.
Right.
Like, not that, and they were more than willing to, like, help me and do whatever. I have, like, the best parents in the world, but from a young age, I remember watching them, like, at age, like, 12 and being stressed, like, for them.
Yeah, and I remember, I went to IEPUI, and the attitude from counselors and presenters and college admission people, it was very much... Go to a private school. You should go to a private school. If you can't go to a private school, then you should go to a state school. And then if you can't go anywhere else, then you go to IUPUI. And so
and your degree will say IU for a third of the cost.
Right. And I tried to get into Marion College.
Oh, God.
And I'm so glad I didn't, because
Catholics.
I would have paid four times what I actually paid. And I had to get a 3.0. To get the scholarship, I got a 2.98, and they wouldn't adjust it, and I'm glad, because I went to IUPUI.
Thank God you didn't do that.
I dropped out 4 years later with $12,000 in debt, as opposed to $50,000, $60,000 in debt,
And, with a worse degree.
And with a worse degree that nobody would have cared about. I mean, was there an attitude, was that attitude the same for when you guys were starting to look at schools? I mean,
Jordan?
I was from Plainfield, so I was around, and you're kind of in the Indy area, too.
Honestly, like, I knew when I started looking at schools that I was going to be the one paying for it. So I was like, wherever I go, I'm going to be in debt. So I'm going to go wherever I feel like I'm going to like it.
Did you have anything towards teaching and education?
No.
No.
So you got here and didn't know what you were going to do yet?
I mean,
it was the teacher's
class. Right, yeah. I mean, what about you? Like, in terms of cost, how much did it factor in for Eugene?
Were you in-state or out-of-state, by the way?
Technically, I'm out-of-state, but I don't pay out-of-state because, like,
you have
my GPA
that
was
here?
No, my GPA was high enough. Like, they, because I live in the Midwest, so they have this, like, Midwest GPA type of deal. So that helped, but I really didn't consider money, which is weird because I think about money a lot, but I feel like money is, like, temporary, so I did not want that to dictate, like, my future and just, like, my future just for the next 4 years. I wanted to, like, follow what I thought would make me happy and, like, what would be best for, like, my major, which I did change my major, but, like...
What'd you start out as?
Child life.
Oh, development? Early childhood development?
Like. No, child life is, like, it's... You're kind of like a social worker, but it's more child development and you're in the hospital with kids. So, like, your job is to, like, play and distract, and, like, when they're, like, getting treatments and stuff, you're, like, kind of
a middleman. Set of jingling keys while they're
getting
chemo. Yeah, and
you can, like, you're not a doctor, so they're not, like, afraid of you. They're not, like, because it's, like, very sick kids. So, like, it's kind of the same, but, like, it's a more, like, focused field.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
So, but, like, most schools don't have that.
No,
so
I think not.
So, like, it's a very...
A lot of hospitals don't have the budget for it, probably, do they?
Yeah. So, like, it's hard to find a job, too. That's part of the reason I switched. But, no, I didn't really let money go into it because I don't like money dictating big decisions and, like, happiness and stuff.
Now, Kat, are you in college?
Surprisingly, shocked that I came back.
For how much longer?
Let's be real. Probably a semester.
Oh, so you go to Ball State?
Yes. No, for me, I turned down a lot of really good, I've told you this before, a lot of really good scholarship money to play soccer, D3, at a few, like, very private schools near where I grew up. And the reason I turned that down, one was, you know, my body was tired and I didn't want to do it anymore. But two, you know, the schools that I was going to commit to didn't even have my major. Or they didn't have...
It was classical liberal arts education, mainly, right?
Yeah, like, they didn't have my major, or they kind of did, but it was, like, a lump.
Yeah, like, when you go there, you have to go to grad school to get, like, vocational-type training.
And so
you know you're taking 6 years.
Exactly. And my thing was, okay, why do I want to go to a school that's right down the street from my house and, you know, commit all of my time and energy to one sport? And I'm not going to become a professional soccer player. And I'm not, or even, I'm, you know, trying to make the most of it, I'm not going to become, like, an exercise science major. So this isn't what I want to do, like, in the long run. So, you know, it was kind of hard to turn all that
down.
It's a
pretty practical decision-making process for a young kid.
I know. And my parents were shocked because they, you know, I grew up with private, you know, club teams and private soccer coaches, one-on-one, camps,
travel fury and all that stuff.
Right. And we never really, you know, practiced or did anything to get me into a school. Because for me, like, and this is kind of controversial, grades obviously were always important, but soccer was always first.
Yeah.
And so the second semester of my senior year of high school, to tell my parents, excuse me, I don't want to play soccer anymore, and to just all of a sudden, I mean, they're great parents, as you guys, you know them. They said, okay, because, and I've said this before, anything I've wanted to do in life, my parents have helped me do, which is great.
Till this,
right.
Honestly.
I noticed that your mother's disappeared from my social
media.
Yeah,
she's not interacting with me on social media.
Right.
What's wrong?
No, she's just
What lies
not,
have you been
she's,
telling?
She's gone back to school, so she doesn't help.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
But, like, to
she
can't
shitpost all day.
Exactly. But to all of a sudden switch to, you know, them giving me, instead of private soccer lessons, private SAT tutoring and all that to get into Ball State, which I always kind of wanted to go because my parents have always gone and the comm department's great. So that was the main factor for me.
Okay, so let's start wrapping up. But I will say that in talking to, talking to Kat, it does sound a little extreme on a college campus, but we all know Kat's dramatic.
Well, it's content.
Right. But I
she's not dramatic. She
saw. Yeah, there was no soot on any of our faces from the fire. There was no damage, as you can see.
All right, please explain to them how comedy works, how the business works.
Honestly, I see a lot of char over there.
Why are you still in blackface? That's offensive.
It's as dark as your perfect brown. But it doesn't seem as crazy up here. It doesn't seem as crazy as, like, from the outside of college campus today. I just sit there and go, I would never want to go. Like the other day at, I think it was Ole Miss or someplace.
Well, the Antebellum South is, yeah, I've seen parades at SEC, because I went to SMU,
right.
And it was a gone with the wind party, and it was pretty clear that they didn't want anybody ruining the visual.
Honestly, I'm sad that I didn't get to see you organize it. It would have been so...
Well, it was a bake sale.
Right. But, it was a Greek party that got canceled because there was a banana in a tree that some kid had chucked off.
On the porch.
And it was hanging off of the tree, and it was... Did you do that on purpose?
I like bananas, and there wasn't a trash can, so I'm not going to apologize.
And so he threw it in a tree.
And then my Challenger got wrecked, somebody jumped out in front of me, and Charlottesville was pissed about it. Big word to help.
Honks and Confederate. And
my friends are broken right now if you're not watching the live stream. They're just...
You can check it out.
Katie's literally shaking like a blizzard over here. She's going to go full snowflake.
On September 4th-ish, on Monday, we'll post the video to YouTube, but... you can check it out on our YouTube channel, but so they canceled this Greek event because people were triggered that the banana signified blacks hanging in a tree, and
I
support that. No,
you read that story and you go, I could never be in college today, but it seems like you guys just roll your eyes.
See,
at
but
it.
That's the extreme stuff we're talking about.
It ruins it for everyone.
Yeah,
one bad Skittle. You know?
Go ahead.
No, I'm just, it's literally for everything. You can't make, it's hard to make anybody understand.
It drowns out any kind of dialogue, any kind of like nuance or anything, and it just makes it look like America's on the verge of a civil war between black, Antifa with their, you know, masks, and then white supremacists carrying Nazi flags. Like, in that, there is no middle.
Yeah, there's like no in between.
No,
like,
you either are a white supremacist or you are trying to be a Wall Street occupier.
Yeah.
How many crosses has Kat burnt on the front lawn of this place?
Listen, just because I don't like blood, no, I'm
kidding. I wish you would stop saying her Christian nightlights.
Yeah.
Thank you. I was hoping that's what she was going to say, but she just doesn't like the dark, so she has to...
Exactly.
She loves Jesus.
She has even people are hiding in it, but...
They're gypsies.
Jordan, I mean, it doesn't seem all that crazy. I mean, how...
You're kind of cocooned from it, huh?
Snowflaked. How snowflakeified is your college experience?
I mean, I feel like you have to think about where you are. You're in Muncie, Indiana. You're not at... We're at Ball State. We're not at some big school.
Or Berkeley,
so,
or...
Yeah, so everything here is not as extreme as it is at other places.
But don't you have that fringe that's, like, out trying to recruit people and get you interested in things with flyers?
Yeah.
Blow it out of proportion?
Yeah, I definitely think so.
You don't just ever, like, go and... Like,
just
I went down to a Bloomington pop rally. We did a thing.
Oh, man.
What did I say to the students of the Democratic Society?
Oh, you immediately walked up to the SDS table and started trolling and asked them if they wanted a helicopter ride. And then they were confused by that. And you said, you know, I love to throw leftists out of a helicopter.
Yeah.
They were so pissed.
Well, communists aren't moral agents, so you're not...
I thought that we had to. Our table was
that
right
pink-haired
next to
girl was pissed.
Honestly,
and she didn't wear deodorant either. Do you know her?
Yeah, there's a group of all of us.
There's a Facebook group.
Yeah.
The last time a girl didn't wear deodorant on this podcast was wearing a sweater like that. Her name was Chloe Anagnos. and she said, I don't smell good. And I said, I don't believe you. Let me get a whiff.
Oh, it was so true.
And I put my nose in her armpit, and it smelled like onions and White Castle and garlic.
It's the Greek armpit.
Yeah.
I didn't thought that was fake. It's real.
No, it's tzatziki sauce.
How are you smelling?
Hold on.
Are you funky?
She's smelling yourself right now.
Like bong water.
I feel like I smell like a middle-aged man after he goes, like, golfing.
Oh, okay.
You know, just, like, after that.
It's a good musk.
Like, yeah, it's like not that bad, but
What does a middle-aged man smell like after he goes golfing?
Like my dad.
Dirty outside smell.
Yeah, that's how I feel.
How often do you...
That's probably why Kat thinks I'm a dirty person.
How often do you shower?
Bi-weekly?
Yeah.
More than that, for sure.
I like... But in the past couple of days, I haven't showered.
Yeah. No.
Got it. Yeah.
Actually the one that showers the most in this house.
No, I shower the most.
Okay, Kat.
Kat.
Mm. I think Katie showers a lot.
No, I think it goes Kat, Jackie, me and Gina, Ty,
Jordan. And then me.
Jordan, you fucking filthy.
You're Pin, the smelly Pin.
How often are you showering?
Once every 3 days.
Oh, that is disgusting.
No, I would say every other day.
Do you like bird bath it at least? Like go in there and spritz some water on
sometimes,
all the, you know, the triangle of death.
No, and you switch shirts with her.
Do you fight Kat and get all sweaty?
Well, I usually win the fights.
Yeah, no, Kat begs for help.
Kat, because I will put one hand on you and you will start to scream.
Yeah, because it's funny. Because I don't want to actually hit you like I did the other day. I slapped you and you wouldn't talk to me for like 2 hours.
Yeah, and then what happened after that? I choked you out.
And then I climbed in your window.
Which we will talk about.
Surprise this. Sex!
We will talk about that in the bonus show. We will hear more of the roommate stories here after this. Alright, so final thoughts. We're going to wrap up the show. Everybody gets to say exactly what they want. If you want Twitter follows, if you want to use it to promote yourself. Like,
are you all coming to the live show on 9/11?
I can't.
No? Got to fly into some towers or something?
I was going to, and then Kat was being an asshole, so I'm not going
anymore. You're not
going
to go?
Jordan.
No, Kat was being mean. I'm not going.
Jordan.
Don't be petty.
Hold my hand.
I'm petty.
Jordan.
Jordan's petty.
You chose the mainstream cat.
Exactly.
It's about you and me.
Here's the thing, I wasn't even mean to her. She just like yelled at me. And then...
Good thing you
didn't. She won't be there.
Her hand was very sweaty.
You
should shower more. What are you doing?
What were you saying?
Oh, I was just saying, yeah, it's fine. I didn't want them to come support me anyways.
Fine.
They should, though. It's going to be fine.
I'll literally be.
I wish, yeah, I have to.
I really wish Jordan would go, but.
Final thoughts, you get to say whatever you didn't get a chance to say during the episode, or promote yourself, or do whatever. It is over.
Take back anything you feel is offensive.
Right.
Kat will show you how it's done. Go ahead, Kat.
Okay. Yeah, so I thought this was a great episode. I was a little bit, like I said, I was kind of nervous, because I didn't want them to come on and be uncomfortable, like, whatever, but I thought you guys really... Oh, shut up. No, I thought you guys really performed well, and I think this is going to be an interesting episode for the viewers, for the listeners. Because it kind of, like I said, it taps into not the media side of college campus, but the grapple work.
Yeah,
what's actually going on.
Right.
What's actually going on, I guess. So, no, I thought it was a great episode. As always, follow me on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, Snapchat, at Kat Anagnos. And thank you, everybody. What is that guy's name who makes the killer memes?
Christian Emmons.
I love you. I'm obsessed with you. Every single meme you make, I make my phone saver, like my background, hilarious. Hilarious, hilarious work. And once again, I'm really glad that you guys got to come to Muncie. It's been a lot of fun.
Every meme you make.
Oh, sorry. I just noticed something. It's been a while since... Sorry.
Do you know what that is?
Scat-cat.
How annoyed with that are you? Everybody writes in and says, I love Kat. Maybe not Scat Kat. It is, and it's 100% of the letters that get sent into editor at WeAreLibertarians.com. It's, Kat has been a great addition to the show, but maybe not Scat Kat.
Interesting that all those accounts are like a day old.
Right. It's Greg.
Gina, final thoughts?
You guys were like a lot more like serious than I thought you were going to be.
We get that a lot.
Yeah.
Our reputation precedes us, and it's not a good reputation, and then we, like, surprise people.
We like the disconnect.
Right.
Yeah.
We want to be thought of like Attila the Hun, but then, like, that are smart and can have a good conversation after we steal your, you know, steal roving hordes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like it was some things I was like, but it was good.
I noticed your expression at one point, so I had to put that out. I was pretty sure that I was going to get hit with an Antifa bat. Or she was going to throw her softball mitt at me with her feminist friends.
Gina, it's been a pleasure having you on the podcast.
Thank you.
Jordan?
I was really nervous to do this. I don't really know.
You're great.
Yeah, you, honestly, God, guys, I'm going to gush after the podcast. I'm so proud of you guys. You guys were amazing.
I feel like I did terrible. When you asked me to describe social work, I was like,
What's
that word?
No, give me change, I'll go show you.
I haven't bathed in a week like Jordan, and I am homeless.
I showered yesterday for everyone wondering, so I'm clean.
Today she's marinating. It's a marinade day.
I smell like an ogre after 12 hours, so I have to bathe like every 12 hours, or else I smell like just a homeless dog that Gina would adopt.
That's very unhealthy for your hair.
Yeah, you're not supposed to wash your hair every day.
Well, let's have a smell test. Everybody smell my hair and your hair and see who they'd rather sit next to.
I see why she
fights with you.
Thank you.
I told her, I said, you know who I'm gonna like the least of your roommates? Jordan.
To be fair,
I didn't know Gina was here. So, but
and now you're in both of the ends.
I'm probably one of the nicest roommates.
And you know what? You know what? I find you very charming. I'm surprised by all of your roommates. Not Jackie. All the rest
of
you are
sales.
Right.
She sells discount jewelry at an outlet.
Oh, yes.
Leaves it laying in the yard. All right.
Hilarious.
Anything else, Jordan? I don't want to cut you off before you're done.
No, this was fun. This was better than I thought.
Did you enjoy it?
Yeah.
Good.
We're glad you decided to participate.
Thanks.
Now, Katie, thank you so much for being here. You were very eloquent, very well spoken.
Thank you.
I was surprised because I thought you were just going to come on and talk about Bernie the whole time and smoking weed.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, Kat, I feel like, has made me come across like a dirty hippie. And
it's constant,
but yeah.
Then she sees the torch on the whole podcast.
Right. But no, I had a really good time. I was like excited for you guys to come because I was excited to like figure out who you guys are, because Kat has been talking about you guys literally nonstop.
Aww.
Really?
Yes.
That's shocking.
Yes. So, or like showing me all the memes or showing
don't,
me
by the way, those are not for everybody in the sorority, so don't turn
no.
those.
No. Everybody in the sorority can see them, so hold the phone up here.
So I've just been eager to meet you guys, and I'm really excited I got to come on.
We'll do it again if you guys want to
do
it.
Oh, yeah. I like sharing.
And we hope you don't have to, no obligations next time we do a live show, because they're pretty fun. We'll have you come up on stage and then you can have a bunch of creepy libertarians swoon over you.
Yeah.
Honestly,
hey, you want to go to lunch? Yeah. Want to meet me at this church in the middle of Muncie?
My produce.
My goats.
Even dressed like this, you ladies will draw a libertarian crowd. So,
you can see all this cow, stop it.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you so much. Greg, you get to go too.
Well, I just want to say thank you for having us. One, because no, I really appreciate it. This has been really fun. You guys are great and really just did wonderful. This has been one of our better podcasts, and you guys had great personalities that you showed off without being nervous. And I appreciate the compliment of how, you know, we're more serious than you thought we were just going to be bomb throwing.
I mean, did she just make it sound like we were going to come on and yell the F and the N and the D word the whole time?
Yes.
A little bit.
She projects herself on us. Uh-huh. On gaslighting. So that's what she does.
Honestly, she gaslights the shit.
And she was like, I'm afraid, I don't know. And I feel like I don't get offended that easily, so I was like,
Kat and I tend to do that whole thing where it gets so vulgar that it's like it compounds to the point of like, oh my god, that white supremacist.
At least once a month, I have to go, Greg or I will look at each other and go, alright, wait, is this socially appropriate? We've lost track.
Oh yeah, but it's so true, it's a phenomenon because you get so used trying to get attention or get on the radar. And if you resort to trying to use shock value, you have to up the ante until it gets to the point like...
And
were you banned from Facebook 17 times?
Maybe,
it was a cyber terrorist, and I bullied him.
Exactly.
Brian Kill. Remember that?
I don't know who it is.
All right.
But no, so thank you so much, and then also thank you. How far Kat has come since you decided to mainstream her into your sorority? I mean, honestly, she couldn't drive. And like now she's dropped, she couldn't eat, she was trapped in her wheelchair.
Okay.
it's incredible.
You look great without
us,
the helmet.
Thank you.
It's stunning to me. And then I'm sure like that's, you know, the short bus for Ball State, I'm sure it doesn't run all the time. You take her your things, you know, strap her in. But you're really well done. And no, Kat, awesome. Thank you for having us.
Yeah,
I hope we didn't get you in any trouble.
Nah.
And stay out of windows.
Yeah.
Seriously. We will talk about all the embarrassing things that Kat has done. in the house. She's desperately looking at her roommates right now, saying, "Please don't tell that story." But we're gonna get Katie to open up, and Jordan, we know, is gonna spill the beans. But you can only get that if you subscribe at Patreon for $5 up a month. And you guys have been so generous. I'm not going to tell you how much we are bringing in a month now, but the podcast now pays for itself. We were able to run $150 worth of ads for our live show on 9/11.
You bought food insurance for mittens and muffins in case you die.
In a week and a half, the amount of money that we are bringing in a month has been overwhelmingly generous.
You guys are the best.
I need you to go to patreon.com/WeAreLibertarians and go to WeAreLibertarians.com on the right-hand side, and you can click through to it and see how much we're bringing in, because it's a stunning amount.
And we hit 10,000. You stripped and danced at the Libertarian National Convention, right?
I'm going to need stripping lessons. Which one of you ladies is good on the pole?
Jordan.
I honestly was going to say Katie, but Jordan, I could see some moves.
What? Thank you for listening to We Are Libertarians.
So if we hit 10,000 a month, then I am going to do a little striptease at a live show. But
with a coach, apparently.
But if you want to hear the special bonus content, you can only get that if you subscribe $5 a month and up. And you get that special content. $10 up a month, you get the live stream of the podcast. We get to take your comments and questions during the show. And special thanks to Craig DaCosta for upgrading to $100 a month. We now have two people, he and Jason Doolittle.
That is amazing.
$100 a month. And
we are so not worth that.
And my birthday is 9-9, September 9th, and Craig sent me a mic processor for my birthday. I literally had it in my shopping cart on Amazon to buy this morning. When I got paid this morning, and it arrived yesterday afternoon. So
best surprise ever.
Oh, it was great. So our Amazon wish list is on the bottom of WeAreLibertarians.com if you want to send us any equipment. That always helps kind of offset the cost, because as we always say, the reason we are trying to sell subscriptions now and raise money is because it costs about $500 a month. I want to do some extra stuff to help give you tools to promote libertarianism. And we can only do that with cash. If I can spend money on freelancers to build apps or JavaScript programs with quizzes, then you can share that with your friends and we can create more libertarians. And you can share this podcast, because without your donations, we're not able to continue to do this podcast. And you guys are so generous and we can't thank you enough. And so all the donations for cash and equipment all go towards that stuff. And I want to thank you so much.
And Spangle, also, thank you for hauling all this up here, because I know I had to be a royal pain.
Yeah, thank you. Honestly, guys, thank you so much for coming up here.
Yeah. Well, I mean, thank Christy Avery, because, like, Christy Avery gave us the Zoom H6N that we are using to record this. The donations help buy the attachment that's $150. The mics have been donated by people like Ryan Ripley. The only reason that we're able to come up to Muncie and do a mobile show is because of people donating equipment and money that we're able to do more stuff. And so when we want to go do a show in Muncie and do it on the road, and we will do more of that.
We'll do an Elkhart show with Mama and Abby.
We're able to do it. So,
oh, yeah. I want you guys to come up to the restaurant.
A woke fest. Yeah. Yes. It's not Greek, though, right?
It's Greek Mediterranean. Like,
oh, it is. Mm-hmm. Okay.
So you get to live chat during the show, and I just want to say a special fuck you to Harry Price, my co-host on the new Tuesday show. Greg, Kat, did you two listen to the Tuesday show?
Not yet.
I saw you with another man, and he was black, and I was intimidated.
I wish that you guys supported me the way that I support you two.
Here we go again with the feelings.
I made a meme specifically in Delta. Of you two cuddling, Ebony and Ivory, like McCartney and Stevie Wonder.
A couple people wrote in and said that they liked the format, they liked the show, and I appreciate that, even though they miss Scat Cat. But I want to say a special fuck you to Harry Price, because Stone Aldridge, superfan Stone, asked if any of you ladies are single. And I told him no. And
I'm so single.
And Harry Price said the single lesbian with the Don't Tread on Me shirt.
Oh.
So, fuck you, Harry. So
still, yes. Support the Yankee side of the Civil War?
Yeah. So, thank you so much for listening to this episode of We Are Libertarians. We will be back next week, and as always, we promise
to do better next time.
Beep, bop, ba, doop, bop, beep.
All right, welcome to the bonus episode of We.
One second.
They have to go.
Yeah, they have a chapter of recruiting.
Oh, shit.
I texted Hannah and said that we were going to be late, and she said that's totally fine. But I understand that you guys don't want to go.
this one.
Should we just tell the story about the window room?
Like 10 minutes.
Want to do a shot and do it?
10 minutes?
Yes. Wait, let me just
quick shot.
I said we would be late. She's like totally fine.
Okay, then we'll just tell
the
story.
Yeah. What do you do? We'll just tell the window story.
A shot?
Oh, I can't. No.
It's fine. We'll go. Let's go.
All right, welcome to the bonus episode here at We Are Libertarians, and we're under a little bit of a time crunch. We want to make this extra bonusy, but we teased during the episode that we would talk more about your fight, Jordan, with Kat, which it sounds like they fight every single night game.
Yeah, and I feel like this is an episode of Dr. Phil right now.
Do you ever like try to moderate, or what? Are you at the point where you just let
no,
them
no,
do
she,
that?
No, like, she has an anxiety attack, and it goes in her room.
Katie does.
Wow.
You hide
that,
bed.
Now there's going to be a third participant after that comes. Yeah.
So what did you two fight about the other night?
Okay, here's how it started. I have one hair tie that I use to keep up my hair, and she took it and flung it behind the couch. My only hair tie.
Did you do this on purpose?
Yes, she did. So, I got really mad.
Are you really particular about, like, an exclusive brand of hair tie? Or
no, it was
like
my last one. Like,
okay.
Hair tie is the only one I
have. Honestly, like,
I noticed.
Because you want it to be very, like, the perfect amount of stretchy.
Okay, so it's a very,
but
it's a brand-specific type.
Get on Amazon and buy some extra is what he's saying.
But, like, do you really want to do that?
But
so, she gets on top of me.
No.
I want you to buy a lot.
First, I asked her to nicely get it for buying the couch, and she refused.
Did you really?
Yes. So then,
you
started like wrestling.
Then then tell her, okay, once we start wrestling.
Why did you throw it then in the first place?
Because at night I get really.
Kat likes to push Jordan's buttons.
No,
yes, she does.
She's an instigator.
She's a little sister. She loves to be a little shit.
Oh yeah.
She gets bored, and so she starts doing things to entertain herself.
So then Jordan, exactly. So then Jordan's screaming at me, you know, get the hair tie. So I reach behind the couch, get the hair tie, and then we just had dinner, and the bowls, the large mixing bowls, were soaking on the counter.
Did you cook that night?
Yeah, I cooked. Okay. We cooked like huge batch of spaghetti, and there's like, you know, they're like kind of gross when you cook spaghetti. You got a little bit of
crusty sauce.
Looks like a murder.
Yeah. Right, exactly. Right. And so I have the hair tie, and tell them what I did. So I was on one side of the coffee table. She was on the other.
And it wasn't on. The hair tie wasn't on her head.
No. Okay. I flung it behind the couch. I get it from the couch, and she's like, I'm hiding behind the table because she's going to come get me. And she said, Kat, give me my hair tie right now. Give it. And say what I did.
She took the hair tie, threw it into the kitchen, and it landed in the crusty pasta bowl.
With, like, still.
Did you, like, pull it back?
Yep,
like,
I pulled it back.
Out?
And
I'm
it.
So proud of you.
Thank you.
It was gross.
Then she leapt over the coffee table, which, if you're watching on the live stream,
is not narrow.
Large.
No, it's
huge.
A coffee table.
Left,
Jesus.
Coffee table.
Left over the coffee table, both hands, and started physically choking me out.
It was not both hands, it was one hand.
She has large hands.
I'm still kind of on her side. You're being a little shit.
So then she's choking me out, and she wasn't really pressing hard, but it's one of those things where I wanted her to press harder, because I'm not in, like, a weird way, but I love...
Like, see how far you can take
stuff.
It.
I love seeing how far I can take it, so I slap her in the face. Then she starts pressing harder.
What
and
are you doing? Like, what were you watching TV just relaxing?
I was getting the hair tie out of the crusty pasta.
You're that girl.
I would be fucking howling.
You pick up your piss cups, you go get the hair tie, you deserve sainthood.
I'm just trying to look out for
swear
house.
To God.
Exactly. So I...
Scoot over.
Oh, sorry. So I...
You're like the potato whisperer.
Right. So then I slap her in the face, and she gets pissed and starts hitting me, and I'm hitting her. And
when you threw the autistic putty...
It hurts.
Yeah.
Why wouldn't I do that? You slapped me in the face.
Oh, because... Exactly. And here's the thing with me, is the whole time I wasn't actually mad, I was laughing. I was cackling so
right.
hard.
Yeah,
it
was
legitimately
mad.
So funny. So then she gets mad at me. She says, Kat, don't talk to me. Goes into her room, slams the door shut, locks it. So I go to the door and start... I'm knocking on the coffee table.
How's
really
it?
Annoying. So annoying. For like 10 minutes straight, I'm just knocking. And she can just
oh
screaming.
Oh my God.
Kat, leave me alone. Screaming.
Next thing I know, I hear a knock on my window. So she had gone outside, gone to the back of the house, and was banging on my window.
Guess
so
what?
I'm
speaking tongue.
So I go like out in the living room, she comes back inside, whatever, I go back in my room. Next thing I know, I hear someone like moving my glass. Kat had gone back outside to the back of the house, lifted up the screen, lifted up my window,
which was unlocked. I did her assault.
And was lifting up my blinds and crawling into my room.
How you doing?
And it was hilarious.
It was not hilarious.
Oh, it was
so you were at one point like halfway in, halfway out, legs dangling in the
no,
air.
No, I climbed physically through the window.
That's what I mean.
Door.
Like at some point though, like you were just like
she like
half
had
in,
her
half
head
out.
In the window and was like
what?
Lifting her leg.
What?
Oh yeah.
Like so you then, all of a sudden you just
you high stepped it in.
Oh yeah.
Yes.
And then, so what did you do? Like
she screamed.
Well, at first I was like, window break right
in,
now because I just hear like the blind and then Kat pops her little head in and I was so mad. I'm surprised I did not grab her by the neck and push her out the window.
Thank God there wasn't a crazy person coming in your window.
Right, exactly.
Bibbidi bop bop bop
bop.
Exactly.
I like that new jig you added to it.
Yeah.
I'm all limbs, baby. I'm all
limbs. When we had a photo shoot with her, she goes, I don't know what to do with my, I just have too many limbs. So why do you guys have a timeout chair for Kat?
Because she does shit like that.
So like, is this obviously like a recurring thing. Like
happens
every
night, ever since we've been friends.
Now this was pretty escalated because it resulted in breaking and entering, slapping.
Yeah.
Like, you know.
She
weaponized hair ties.
She violated the nap.
Yeah.
She destroyed property.
She forced friendship on her roommate.
Yeah. Exactly. But so what are some of the things that she's done to put herself in the chair?
She doesn't want to do her homework. So whenever she starts to pout about doing her homework, she gets like 5 minutes in the chair.
Which she does, doesn't she? And sits there and stomps her feet and pouts.
She's like, I'm saying, these aren't my mom. You can't tell me what to do. Pay attention to me.
The thing is, she always said, you're not my mom. You can't tell me what to do. But when you tell her to do something, she does it. So she listens to us anyways.
Right.
Mm-hmm. It's for her own good.
Exactly. They have my best interest in mind.
So, clearly, I heard about, you know, some of the circumstances resulting in a lack of homework being done that you're in the predicament you're in at the moment.
Yeah.
However, what are the other, because clearly, like, you don't just slap someone. You feel, there's got to be a level of comfort when you would smack someone in the face to see if they'll up the ante. So,
oh, yeah,
what
is.
Are some of, like, the past ones where have been a little less physically aggressive?
I remember one night, because I was recording the whole thing. I still have it.
We need that immediately.
Yeah, I'll do so.
I'll
hit you up.
We're exchanging all the numbers.
But one night, we were all in my dorm room, so this was last year, and Kat had stolen Jordan's rice that she was going to eat later when we had, like...
Like a bag or like an... Like a
like
bag?
Like one of those rice.
Yeah.
So Jordan, like, bought that specifically because we had, like, gone out with some friends and then we were coming back and Jordan was really excited. She was like, I'm going to make pepperoni.
Your food is rice?
It's cheesy rice.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I knew how excited she was going to eat. Yeah. So Jordan was, like, talking about it all night. She's like, I'm so excited to eat this cheesy rice. Kat steals it. And she eats it. Not only does she eat it, she spills some of it in my bed. And then Jordan got so mad at her that she grabbed a cup of water and just dumped it all over
and then
she pushed me backwards
so
and I fell down and she's like laying in a puddle and she like can't get up
and I do this every night in bed.
She's laughing hysterically.
I'm used to this and this is just water.
And then the one time when we were in a fight when was I sitting on like a rolling desk chair and you pushed me. Do you remember this? Jordan grabbed my hair and pulled me down and I crumbled on the Do you remember that?
I never did.
What had you done to deserve this, is the real question.
I don't really do anything. I'm an angel.
So what's one more thing that she did to get herself in the timeout chair? How did the timeout chair start, for instance?
Kat came into the house asking if we could make her a behavior chart.
Oh, yeah.
Are you kidding?
To start the year?
Like, the behavior charts that I will make in my future kindergarten
class. I decided for her. I want her to have practice.
This is why she color codes your planner.
Exactly.
You got a yellow card.
Why did you want
to? I need Natalie to sign this form and write what you're going to do.
Well,
and change
I have a behavior problem.
What is it? Why do you think you have a behavior problem?
Well, because I choke people out and break in windows.
She purposefully does things to see what people will do.
Exactly.
I found you to be an incredibly conscientious, like, thoughtful...
That was in a professional environment.
Yeah.
That's the thing, and that's why I'm so excited for you guys to come here tonight, because the Kat that this summer Kat, is so foreign and alien to them that they would be shocked to see that Kat.
Yeah, you're just... Well, you are a little shit. You're a little punk. You're like everybody's little sister. And you just love to poke, poke, poke. And like my brother did that, he'd poke, poke, poke. And when I'd hit him, I'd get in trouble.
Exactly.
And, like, where are you at? Do you have brothers and sisters?
I'm the oldest of four.
I'm the
so
oldest.
So then you were
three.
Terrorized, and you're the youngest, so you were the terrorizer.
Right, and you are the
I'm
youngest.
I'm the youngest, but, like, I didn't really, my sister was, like, pretty dramatic, and so uh-huh. I was more like, I was PTSD. Like, just give me a minute, I need to relax.
Right. So... So you just started having none of it then, Jordan. That's why you two fight.
That's the dynamic.
Yeah.
The oldest sibling
and the youngest sibling.
Because we never fight.
No.
Katie and I
same
never
team.
Fight.
Yeah.
Youngest sibling.
Right. That's why Kat will always try and, you know, she doesn't know. Maybe she doesn't think she does it, but she does kind of like poke at me a little bit.
Yeah, she definitely does.
But at the same time, we'll get in a fight 3 minutes later. Like, she'll text me, come to my room and lay down.
It's a friendship
fight.
Yeah, no, it's usually the next day.
Yeah.
When you're not forcibly entering.
Right.
Exactly.
So one more thing that got her in the chair. What is on the behavior chart, for instance?
Do your homework.
I'm trying to think. I mean, I'm a good kid.
We have to limit the amount of, like, sugar.
Yeah,
she
the
eats.
Sugar.
What?
Because one time we made a plate of brownies the other day, and we told Kat she could have one. Because
what
at
kind
night,
of brownie?
At night, she gets excited without any sugar.
Right.
And then we were like, okay, well, like, each just have a brownie. Kat ate, like, three. And then she was like,
oh, my God.
Does sugar do it to you?
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Hyper?
Well, I never really had, like, a ton of sugar
that's
as a
right.
kid.
That's right, yeah.
I never would drink pop or anything like so, that.
It was baklava so only.
Exactly.
Is it like having a baby?
And Jordan and I were talking about this today. It's so strange because I can go, like, do a, you know, granted, I can go do a podcast or go do work or go do very serious stuff. But then at the same time, if I have three, like, Sour Patch Kids, I'm bouncing all over the place.
Hey, guys, what are you doing?
Yeah.
That is true, because at work, she would go and raid the candy.
Yeah,
and then she'd come,
idea.
And,
okay.
then she'd start shaking her leg,
oh,
and
yeah.
like, and now it makes sense.
Yeah.
I know what you're talking about.
Or she'll just, like, start pacing back and forth.
Yes.
And she can't sit still.
Right. That time you were actually, like, were well-rested for the episode, when you were out on, I was talking to you outside on your patio, I was like, she's pretty amped.
Yeah. It's because I had, like, a cookie.
Then you slept. Like, you took a nap beforehand, and I was
yeah.
like, who is this?
Yeah.
This is interesting.
Kat
she slept well.
Kat doesn't naps.
No. I sleepwalk terribly. Talking about
do
I?
I
nap.
Oh, yeah, she does.
I nap.
Did she ever come into your room sleepwalking?
No, but I was sleeping on the couch the other night, and Kat came into the kitchen to, we have, like, a Brita. You know, the, like, filters on water.
Basically, girls get it.
Yeah, basically. And she tried to pour it, and the whole thing tipped over, and it spilled all over the counter,
yeah.
and she left it there. And she was sleepwalking, and then she went into this closet.
You sure she was like, this sounds convenient for somebody.
No, it's true.
It was she went in the coat closet, and I was like, Kat, what are you doing? And she was like, I'm so cold. And she just puts on a coat. And she went back in her room.
And here's the thing, I do a lot of shit for attention, but, like, the sleepwalking.
This needs to be recorded.
Honestly, we're trading numbers with all of them, and we're getting full reports.
Oh, yeah.
I thought you'd already
have
traded
you seen
with
the Taylor
Gina.
Swift
and
videos.
Oh, they've seen the Taylor Swift videos.
They've seen the Taylor
yeah.
Swift videos.
Yeah, I hated the Taylor Swift song. I'm sorry, Kat.
But did you see the music video?
No, it's not a good song.
No.
Don't worry, we've seen the music video about 8 times now.
Oh!
I heard that's why you got, like, banned from.
I get banned a lot.
Okay, wait, real quick. I told this story real quick. We have another thing to go to, but we're fine to be late to. Can you guys please, I told the story, I didn't do it justice, tell the story of when you got Greg banned from flying.
I didn't get him banned from flying.
I get searched every time I fly.
So, Greg...
I've had to shut my phone service off twice.
Greg was going to Disney World with a previous mistake of his, and...
She's not a mistake, just not, didn't work out.
And so they flew down, she doesn't live in the state anymore, it's fine.
No, but she knows every single person that listens and operates in a functioning role with them.
So they were flying to Disney World, and so Greg innocently checks in on Facebook and says, you know, I'm getting ready to get on the plane to go to Orlando.
The Libertarian National Convention was in Orlando, which I wasn't going to go hang out with those creepers at all.
Right.
I was like, well, we'll go to Disney World. It'll be fun.
So
as a kid.
I just waited. About the time, and I
35 minutes exactly.
I looked at the timestamp and I was like, if I wait 2-5 more minutes, he's probably going to be on the plane and his phone will be off. And so I went and took 600 NSA keywords that they searched the internet for and put them on his status.
That's a comment.
Which then gave our friend John, who is the preeminent troll of all time, the idea to tweet to Homeland Security, the
and
TSA,
Southwest.
The FBI.
Known terrorist, RGT Lens, is about to board your flight.
And so when then the plane got delayed 30 minutes.
No mechanical issue, just standing there in the, you know, business class pre-boarding waiting to get on.
Greg gets to Orlando, gets his bag, goes back to the hotel, opens it up, and sees that he has been thoroughly searched.
Tore apart everything, took all of my toiletries, razor, every single thing, even the things you're allowed to have, gone. Only then there was articles of clothing.
Yeah.
And every single one of them had been, like, turned inside out and just wadded up. And then I had two separate, I had one, the regular letter saying had been searched, and then another one, I can't remember exactly what it was, but it was for the escalated search, or
right.
The more involved search. God.
And then all your toiletries had been gone.
Shaving cream, deodorant, I know you're, I mean,
yeah.
I went and bought more. Not judging, but, yeah, and so that every single thing when I opened it up that night, because I just had dinner with Chloe and Brett, and I would get to the hotel, and I am like, oh my God. I'm never, and so every time since I've flown since then, my bag's been searched, and I get pulled aside.
Huh. Oh my gosh.
Forever, for life.
It wasn't malicious. And so I was like, there's no way. There's no way that in the span of 5 minutes that we caused that. Then we saw.
But we didn't know why, because Jonna got on Twitter and tweeted directly to all of them.
But even then, it was just like, no way.
And then I'm with, though.
But then we see Snowden, and I looked at him, and I was like, I'm sorry, dude, that was me. That totally...
Because, yeah, I have flown, you know, multiple times since, and every single time I'm pulled out of the line.
Yep.
Huh.
Did I say two fingers? Make it three.
So yeah, that is... that's just...
Well, then you trumped... When, during the campaign, Trump gave out Lindsey Graham, senator from South Carolina's phone number, so people could call him. He thought, this will be hilarious. I'll do it to Greg.
Was hilarious.
1,000 text messages commenced. Someone put it in an auto texter. And the same individual then...
No longer welcome here.
Yeah, gave a militant secessionist from Idaho where my exact location was, and he showed up for wanting to hang out for 2 hours and screech about, America's going to hell.
Which I didn't know that actually happened.
That's
know.
Really out of me.
I didn't know.
Because he wouldn't leave, and I didn't know how to get him to leave.
Right.
Which is why he's not really a listener anymore and around anymore.
Oh, really?
Mm.
Big loss. It's our former least favorite listener, Josiah.
The Crohn's disease.
Hated that kid. I knew I hated him for a reason. And then, so that's just some of the crazy
antics
shit
we get into.
Had to shut phone service off twice.
Yeah.
Creepy secessionist showing up and get searched, you know, get a nice little check of the oil every time I fly.
Added a co-host.
That was arguably the worst decision. I'd take an anal cavity search over... I'm just kidding. I love cavity.
All right, guys. Thanks so much for joining us on this episode of We Are Libertarians. We appreciate you so much, and we thank you for donating. And we'll have her roommates back on to tell more embarrassing stories of Kat, because it sounds like she's a treasure trove. Every time she's on, she's like Harry. Every time she's on, we learn something new and crazier. So thank you so much for joining us on this bonus episode of We Are Libertarians, and we will see you next week.
Woo. You gotta run?
Yeah, we should probably go.
Yeah,
I'll wait. I'll come later.
Can you turn...
Yeah, you don't recruit, so... Oh.
Can we talk about getting her on the front page of Instagram?
They both have been on. I haven't been.
It's yeah. I don't know how a girl who was on a radio show with 3 million people didn't make the Instagram, but...